absolutely beautiful night in Tampa, Florida. Let's go down to the field and Leah Secundo.
Well, thanks very much. One of the storylines on the week, the kicking situation. Billy Gramatica has missed the last two games due to a strained groin muscle. Enter Tony Umholtz. Tony's the punter on the team, a four-time consecutive Division I AA Special Teams Player of the Week. But it looks as though Jim Leavitt has made his decision, and Tony Umholtz will be the kicker this evening. Al?
And Umholtz will kick off. Back to receive, Jermaine Washington and Amon Powell. It'll be Washington at the 5-yard line. He tries a reverse, and the Bulls are ready for it. Right there, ready to make the tackle for the Bulls is Julian Johnson, along with last week's hero, John Chivas.
And I'll tell you, that's a good thing that they faked the reverse, because the reverse was wide open, so the Bulls kind of walked into that one.
Here's a look at the starting quarterback.
Ball is at the Wildcats
of New Hampshire, Ryan Day. Very young quarterback. He's had his moments. 8 touchdown passes, but he's also had 10 interceptions. First down from the 18-yard line for New Hampshire. Very big and strong football team. 50-50, a run to pass. This is Creeder, the fullback. All kinds of room there to the 30-yard line before he is tripped up by Marshall Smith.
Marshall Smith on the tackle.
Here's a look at the Southern Ford starting lineups, an offensive line that averages nearly 300 pounds from left tackle to right tackle. And I'll tell you what, these backs and receivers are also big in Curran and Creeder. This is Curran, averaging over 100 yards per game. He takes it up to the 39-yard line. The Southern Ford starting lineup on the defense for the South Florida Bulls. Blunt, Edwards, Walls, and Hay up front. The defensive backs and the linebackers. Williams, Mitchell, Mark Brown, Davis, Mans, and Henry. Different type of formation here. Look at the four receivers up at the top of the screen.
Here we go. That's a strong Emery is what I tell you what.
From the shotgun, and a flag is down.
And of course, Al, you know, they came really with a no-huddle offense in this first segment of plays here, and we got a flag on the field here, and I think this is going to be against New Hampshire. It's the amazing thing is they don't make many mistakes, but they made one there. Illegal procedure, I don't think they had enough guys on the line of scrimmage.
There's your head coach for the Wildcats of New Hampshire, Sean McDonnell, former defensive back on this team.
The offense, illegal formation, 6 men on the line.
That's exactly what it was.
5 yards from the previous spot, repeat the down.
McDonnell takes over for Bill Bowes, who was with this team for some 20-some-odd years. And then over on the other side, of course, you've got Jim Leavitt, who has built this program from the ground up. And here he is in year number 3, rated number 17 in the country and eyeing a spot in the playoffs. But believe me, this New Hampshire team is extremely dangerous. And the Bulls, coming off a victory over number 6 Illinois State, do not want to stub their toes tonight. Absolutely nowhere to go for Stephen Lewis and that Bulls defense. Not fooled by any formation. Kawika Mitchell on the tackle for South Florida.
Yeah, and the perimeter plays against the speed of this defense is a tough matchup. And look at the big guys here. This is really a wing T play, a wing T sweep. You know, both guards pulling. That's a heck of a job by Kawika Mitchell. Wow.
Third down and 6. Sets up a big third down play. 36. Again from the shotgun. Day looking deep. He's got a wide receiver out there and not being able to hang on to the football. And a flag is down.
Yeah, and I think obviously that's going to be interference against South Florida, Bernard Brown. And he was just a little bit late getting his head back for the ball. I think, you know, it's exactly what the call is. And he was late getting his head back for the ball. And really, that's why he got the interference penalty.
Kamal Peterson not able to hang on to the football. Brown and Davis in the neighborhood.
Defensive pass interference. 15 yards from the previous spot. First down.
And you'll see it right here in the replay. You can see right here that his head is not back to the football. And that's when you're going to, they're going to call that every time. The head being back really is the key. And he was beat a little bit. That's why he didn't have his head back.
Bernard Brown on the cover. This is Curry, finds the left side, cuts it up, and the Bulls are right there.
And I think that's Kawika Mitchell again, and that's really the same play. That's the wing T power off tackle with bringing both guards.
Ja'Quoy Bunt among the tacklers for the South Florida Bulls. Gain of one on the play, second down and nine. Day Red at number two in the Atlantic 10 Conference in passing, some 226 yards per game. Number four in total offense. Again, no huddle. Washington in motion right up to the fullback. He's a backup fullback. Rowan Baptiste, he takes it up near the 40-yard line. About 2 yards shy of a first down, sets up third down and two. And something that's interesting with this Wildcat offense, it converts 53% of its third down.
That's incredible, it really is. And boy, they're really going at a very fast pace. The offensive line never goes back in the huddle. They stay right on the line of scrimmage.
Third down and two from the 40-yard line. Opening drive of the game. Once again, it's the fullback, Baptiste, and the Bulls believe they stop him.
Well, this is going to be real, real tight. Boy, you know, even the backup fullback, the Baptiste, 237 pounds, he's a load. You know, and while they're measuring here for the first down, the reason they're running this offense, let's take a look at it. This is just the straight fullback dive. You know, the reason that they're running this style of offense, Al, is it does not allow you to substitute to their personnel groupings because they leave the line right on the line of scrimmage and they run their personnel grouping on the field and you don't have time to react defensively to get your nickel or dime defense on the field.
New Hampshire is short of the first down, inches away. It'll set up third down. Make that fourth down in inches.
Yeah, they're going to go for this. Of all this bulk up front, I believe I'd want to go for it as well.
Baptiste again, 237 pounds. He's the fullback, number 41. Quarterback snap. Ryan Day. He's over 200 pounds. And it's enough to get the first down.
Yeah, this Bulls defense is really going to have their hands. Nobody has really slowed down this offense all year long. Even in the three losses New Hampshire's had, they've all been to outstanding teams, but they have put a lot of points on the board against everybody.
New Hampshire leads the Atlantic 10 in offense, averaging some 452 yards of offense per game. Here comes the blitz. Day gets it away, nearly picked off by the Bulls. The blitz by Anthony Williams. Yeah, and Vasse Mark nearly picked off the pass.
Yeah, Vasse Mark really had terrific, terrific coverage. And of course, good pressure on the quarterback with the blitz as well. Vasse Mark is really having an outstanding year. He's really an interesting player. Watch the pressure you're coming from the blitz. This is Mitchell, and that's Anthony Williams. Excellent job by Vasse Mark.
Second down and 10. This is Curran. He cuts it up. Once again, the Bulls are right there waiting for it. One, two, three, four Bulls. Vasse Mark leading the charge along with Steve Hatley.
Yeah, that was great, great effort from the backside by Steve Hatley. He's a backside defensive. This shows the speed of South Florida where he can run that down from behind.
Gain of one on the play. Sets up a third down and nine. Yep. One more look, Doug Graber.
Yeah, watch this is the wing T sweep. Watch 55 Hatley here run this thing right down from behind. What an effort that is.
From the shotgun on third down, Day has some room. He hits his receiver. They're saying it's complete. Jermaine Washington with the catch, and it appears to be another first down for the Wildcats of New Hampshire.
You know, for South Florida, this is one thing you cannot get off of the films. And of course, you don't live scout anymore in college football. And I know they didn't know that they were running this fast-paced offense. I don't know if they've done it all year, but I suspect they have because they're executing it very well. Again, really a no-huddle offense all the way through so far. Tough to get adjusted to defensively.
You answer so tough on third down. Play action. Day. Has a receiver inside the five. Kamal Peterson not able to hold on. Bernard Brown in coverage for for the South Florida Bulls.
And this really was a completion, and Bernard Brown does a great job of coming in and stripping the football, but this is a completion. Let's take a look at it here. Here's the play action strong, running a boot weak. You'll see Peterson come across the field here. Boom. Nice job of the right hand in on the football.
Second down and long from the 27-yard line. New Hampshire on the move on the opening drive of the game. The Bulls threaten the blitz. Flags down.
Well, I think what happened is they jumped up in a blitz look and somebody moved up front, which, of course, that's exactly what you want them to do. That's going to set up back five.
Now, this is a football team. Edward Ardito, the referee.
Dead ball foul. False start on the offense. 5 yards from the previous spot. Second down.
Penalties have killed the Wildcats throughout the season. They're averaging 10 penalties per game this season. Rick Kravitz, the defensive coordinator, already getting his money's worth already tonight. From the 32-yard line, second down and 15. Play action. Dave comes back the other side. Baptiste on the screen. Very close to the first down, so they get it back in a hurry.
And a late flag coming in. I really didn't see anything that looked not appropriate. Possibly late hit. I don't know.
It is against the South Florida Bulls, and this will take this deep into USF territory near the 10-yard line.
Well, that's the second time now that they've run the weak side screen into the short side of the field, both times for big plays.
Third down and two.
Dead ball foul, personal foul. Late hit out of bounds on the defense. Half the distance, automatic first down.
And here they are lined up ready to run another play again already, and let's take a look at it. That's a bad call, I think.
They quickly to the air. Catching it in the end zone. Randall Williams, the touchdown catch. 10 yards on the play, and like that, New Hampshire with the score. And the 6-0 lead.
Well, I mean, what a great drive to start the football game by this New Hampshire offense. I mean, unbelievable. I mean, and really the biggest factor in this drive was the no huddle aspect of this offense. They never really could get their feet set on the ground. I'm speaking of South Florida.
Peter Carbonara to attempt the point after. Remember, the Bulls blocked one last week. And this is good. So on the opening drive of the game, New Hampshire works the clock and works the field, going more than 80 yards for the touchdown. One more look. It is Ryan Day looking for his wide receiver, Randall Williams.
It's half time for the double tree guest suite.
Good for 9 yards and a touchdown, and the 7-0 lead for the Wildcats of New Hampshire. .43 left to go in the first. We expected a wild, high-scoring ball game. So far, New Hampshire has drawn first blood.
Well, they really did, and they controlled the clock. I mean, that was a terrific, terrific drive, but they've done this to everybody. So, like we said in our opening, the South Florida offense is going to have to answer.
82 yards and 13 plays. 9-yard touchdown pass, Randall Williams from Ryan Day. This is Reuben at the 20, has a lane. A block past the 30-yard line, near the 40-yard line, so the Bulls will have excellent field position to answer.
Yeah, and that's a terrific job by special teams coach Renato Diaz. They double-teamed the second and third guy in, and they had planned to bring it right up the sideline, and that was a terrific job right there. Excellent field position. And now let's see if the South Florida offense, which has been very inconsistent, can help the defense here a little bit and control the ball for them.
Markwell Blackwell, 10 touchdown passes on the season, only 4 interceptions. Closing in on the 1,000-yard mark. From the shotgun, quick pass. McCready tries to dance away from the 40-yard line, and New Hampshire closes in. Here's a look at the Southern Ford dealers. Starters for the South Florida offense, Joey Sipp making his 30th consecutive start for the Bulls. In the backfield, it'll be Raphael Williams, Darryl McMillan, R.J. Anderson, a wide receiver, Jackson and Guerrero. Gain of 1 yard on the play, second down and 9. Bulls trail 7-0. Williams with the big hole over the left side. Gets up near the 45-yard line, so a good gain on second down. Here's a look at the Southern Ford dealers. Starters on defense for New Hampshire. It's an a defensive line that is large, but doesn't get a whole lot done so far. Bashaw is one of the top tacklers in the Atlantic 10 leading this defense. Schweda, also one of the defensive captains for the Wildcats. Third down and 3. The Bulls on their opening series, already trailing 7-0. R.J. Anderson was wide open. Markwell Blackwell simply overshot him.
Yeah, that's just a simple misfire, and this is what you cannot afford to have happen if you're the South Florida Bulls. Three plays and out, and now you got to punt the football back to that explosive New Hampshire offense. And, offensively, South Florida is going to have to do better than that if they're going to have an opportunity to win this game.
Tony Umholtz, who has been so valuable for the Bulls all season. Four consecutive weeks, he has been the special teams player of the week for Independence in Division I AA. It's a line drive punt at the 12-yard line. Amon Powell, and he is leveled. .759 left to go in the first quarter. New Hampshire will have the football for a second time, and the Wildcats lead 7-0. What a beautiful night in Tampa, Florida. New Hampshire says it's looking even better to them. Right now leading 7-0, going 82 yards to a touchdown on its opening drive, aided by a pass interference penalty by the South Florida Bulls and some big plays on third down. First and 10 from the 20-yard line. It's Washington in motion. The fullback, Baptiste, right up the gut. Good gain on first down. Bessie Mark among the tacklers for the South Florida Bulls.
You know, New Hampshire really caught a break with this weather. You know, big football team from the Northeast hasn't had much warm weather, and they got a break tonight with a cool evening here in Tampa.
It's a gain of 5 yards on the play, second down and 5. The running back Curran is in the slot on the left side. Quickly to the air. Nearly picked off by the Bulls, going up high to knock it away. Sean Hay.
Well, Al, okay. 3rd and 5. Now, this is a team that through the season, 53% of their third down conversions. That is an amazing figure. Let's take a look at it here. Big Sean Hay gets up and knocks it down there. And really, the slant was open. It's a good thing he got it knocked down.
3rd down and 5. Big third down play for the Bulls defense. Quick pitch. And a flag is down. The Bulls are right there. Roy Mann's on the tackle for the South Florida Bulls. But let's see what this penalty is.
They do it all. That was the shovel pass now, which we haven't seen that yet this year.
The holding penalty.
I think you got to decline this. That puts the punter on the field. If I'm Jim Levin, I definitely want
to. You know what? When you have a team that's hitting 53% of its third down conversions, you don't take any chances at all.
No, sir.
Holding against the offense is declined. 4th down.
So Sean McClain will come in to punt. He's averaging only 33 yards per punt this season. Charlie Jackson hoping to give the Bulls some good field position here. Are the Bulls going for the block? McClain standing at his 10. Here come the Bulls. Very high. Beautiful spiral. This is a beautiful punt. And the Bulls call a fair catch at the 30-yard line. Here comes a flag. Now, it appeared that Terry McSweeney did not give Charlie Jackson, what do you need, 2 yards there?
Absolutely, you need 6 feet. He didn't get it, so that's an appropriate call.
So this will give the Bulls even better field position.
Yeah, that's a 5-yard penalty.
5-yard violation for interference with the opportunity. On the kicking team, 5 yards, first down.
.659 left to go. Charlie Jackson with the fair catch. McSweeney too close, and the Bulls will get the football for the second time tonight when we come back. Just less than 7 minutes left to go in the opening period. New Hampshire scoring on its opening drive, 7-0. The lead over the South Florida Bulls. Raphael Williams cuts back over the 40-yard line.
You know, Al, the injury, the knee injury to Otis Dixon early in the year has really hampered the South Florida offense, because now what you have to do is, you know, when you want to go to a two-back, you got to move your best running back, McMillan, to fullback, and that hurts.
Gain of 6 yards on the play. Second down and 4. The Bulls with 4 wide receivers and the one back in the backfield. Here he is, Heath Smith, and he ain't going anywhere. Coming in to make the tackle, Chris Robinson. He's a freshman. Big time hit on Hugh Smith.
And what that was is that New Hampshire, you can't quite see it here, but New Hampshire stemmed the defense late and brought the outside back. Yes, and he was unblocked because he moved up there in a late, too late to adjust the blocking schemes to it. And that's part of their style. I think you're going to have to vary your huddle and cadence against this defense.
No gain on the play. Triple wide receivers. Charlie Jackson in motion. Third down and 4. Quick drop. R.J. Anderson went one way. The pass went the other. And this will set up another 3-and-out for the Bulls and another punts.
Well, they brought the corner on the blitz. The quarterback read it, but the wide receiver didn't. And that's a classic example. You've got to have your head on a swivel. You got to see what's going on. Good read by Blackwell, but R.J. Anderson totally missed the read.
So once again, the Bulls not able to do anything offensively. Had their opportunity on a third down pass. Anthony Umholtz, the 45-yarder, his first time out. Punts it away, Amon Powell. That might have hit a player from New Hampshire, and the Bulls simply cannot get there. It looked like it hit Jason Marshall in the back of the leg. But New Hampshire will get the football at the 11-yard line and try to add to its lead. The Wildcats lead it 7-0 over the South Florida Bulls. Has fallen upon the Tampa Bay area. Beautiful night here at Raymond James Stadium. New Hampshire leading the South Florida Bulls at 7-0. Stay tuned in to Sports Channel Florida Saturday mornings. Throughout the college football season, the lineup includes Saturday morning college kickoff at 10 a.m. followed by the Jim Leavitt Show at 11, Butch Davis Show at 11:30, and the Big Ten Game of the Week at noon right here on Sports Channel. Coming up to make the tackle, Roy Manns for the South Florida Bulls.
And that was a good job of Roy Manns of staying home, and they had the pitch cut back, which is again a different play. And again, already you have the offensive line at no huddle, right up to the line of scrimmage. Here comes the quarterback, and he will call the play for everybody right from the line of scrimmage.
No gain on the play. Second down and 10 from the 11-yard line.
Unbalanced.
Curran in motion. Hand off to Baptiste, the fullback. He gets it up to the 15-yard line. Now, Baptiste is the backup fullback. The starting fullback, Dan Kreider. We have not seen him since the opening series. He had 184 yards last week in the win over Northeastern, so it appears he's out with an injury. We'll try to get you updated on that.
Yeah, and he's also, Kreider, the starting fullback, is also their second leading receiver, so that hurts this offense.
All right, here comes a third down play. Once again, coming into this game, New Hampshire 53% on third down. And again, a different looking formation from the Wildcats. And movement on the offensive line.
Yeah, now that's going to turn into third and 10, because they definitely, that's definitely on New Hampshire. And this is unusual, because I watched a lot of tape on this team.
5 yards previous spot until third down.
And they don't make a lot of mistakes, but they're making mistakes tonight, and that will put your offense at a dead stop.
Sean McDonnell, former player at New Hampshire, the head coach, 3-3 in his first year. He's also the offensive coordinator of this team for 5 years. So third down and 10. And the South Florida Bulls call a timeout.
Well, this is really a chess match going on. New Hampshire is running guys on and off the field. And, of course, with the no-huddle offense, South Florida had the nickel on the field. They thought they were in their four wide receiver set. They came out with normal personnel. Now you got a wasted timeout. This offense can really get you totally out of sync with what you're doing on the defensive side of the ball.
Boy, look at McDonnell just giving it to his offensive line.
I think that is the
that's the center, Jason Ball.
Yeah, and I think that he's the guy that's telling us he's the one that made the mistake on the last offsides. That's always a clear indication, believe me. Oh, Coach Kravitz has really had a tough week this week. He's been kind of hurting physically. He's had some problems. And, boy, this offense will really give you problems on top of that.
Third down and 10. So far tonight, the Wildcats have had their way with the Bulls on third down, and they haven't been all short third down plays. He picked up some yardage on third down to continue that opening drive, an 82-yard drive. They gave the Wildcats a 7-0 lead on its opening drive. 4:02 left to go in the first. Wildcats lead it at 7-0. Third down and 10. Day to the air, looking deep, trying to find his wide receiver, Randall Williams, who caught the touchdown pass. Incomplete. Anthony Henry on coverage for the South Florida Bulls.
And that's one thing they really should be able to do. South Florida, with their outstanding three corners now, I'm calling it now, with the emergence of LaFane Williams, they should be able to press these wide receivers and really take them away. I think they have the ability to do that.
Sean McClain standing in his end zone. Charlie Jackson back to receive near midfield. McClain came in averaging 33 yards per punt, had a 45-yarder to start things off. Flag is down. And this is a shorter punt. Jackson calls for a fair catch near midfield, but let's see what the flag is. It is against the Wildcats of New Hampshire, so you push it back a little, 5 yards back.
Absolutely, I think you take this penalty because now, you know, they're going to punt it from about the 5-yard line. And, you know, that puts the punter right, almost right to the back of the end zone.
Illegal formation on the kicking team. Penalty is declined. First down.
Interesting.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised they declined that penalty.
So the Bulls will still get very good field position at the 48-yard line. Markwell Blackwell, it's been three and out twice for the Bulls. Ironically, on third down, they had their opportunities both times to hit completions, but the Bulls have not been able to hook up. 7-0 Wildcats.
They simply have to settle down here offensively now.
Blackwell, plenty of time. He has McCready. That's good for a first down near the 30-yard line.
Boy, and Jackson was also wide open on the crossing route. This is basically a zone team, and you're going to have seams in this zone all the time. They try to, what we call, from a coaching standpoint, is play what we call a matchup zone, which means they're going to take guys in their zones man-to-man. But there should be cracks.
It's a 16-yard gain for the Bulls. Their first big play on offense. From the 31-yard line. First and 10. Bulls trail 7-0. 3:23 left to go in the opening period. Darryl McMillan over the 30.
Yeah, and you know, again, you got a young quarterback here for South Florida, and if they're going to try to call audibles, they're going to give New Hampshire time to stem back and forth defensively, which is really a base part of their scheme. They're going to do it almost every snap, and then your audibles are inaccurate.
It's a gain of 4 yards, second down and 6.
Boy, that big, strong, tough football team.
That's Ned Finneran, defensive tackle on this Wildcat defense. Reuben right in his hands. Right now the Bulls are not hitting on all cylinders.
Yep, and now that's going to bring up third down. And of course, here comes the nickel defense on the field. Let's take a look at it here. Some definite confusion here on the offensive side of the ball. He's got to make that catch. Dan Reuben's got to. It looked like he was trying to run before he got it, Al.
It would have been enough for the first down. and kept his drive alive. Bulls trail 7-0. From the 28-yard line, 6 seconds on the play clock. And movement on the Bulls' offensive line.
Yeah, and that was Man Mountain at right tackle, Joe Condren. And, of course, there was an audible being called, and he got a little bit antsy and started rocking back. And you see it happen every Saturday in college. You see it happen every Sunday in the NFL.
Jim Leavitt, 9 on the nails.
Boy, I'll tell you what.
And for good reason.
Yeah, absolutely. You're down 7-0 to a good football team, and your offense is really, really struggling.
And really, this offense has struggled since the Liberty game a couple of weeks ago. It was a 28-0 victory for the South Florida Bulls. Last week, only 2 touchdowns and the victory over Illinois State. Third down and 11. From the shotgun. Blackwell with time. Reuben at the 5. Touchdown, South Florida. And a flag is down and may be coming back.
Yeah, and I have to agree with the call. Your freshman right offensive tackle, Joe Condren, wrapped him up. He was getting beaten. He pulled him down. And I really think had he not done that, that the defender would have gotten to the quarterback. It's a good call by the official.
On the offense, holding 10 yards to the previous spot, still third down.
Well, when it rains, it pours. You know, when you need a play to get yourself going, and when you're struggling, this is exactly the kinds of things that seem to continually happen.
Well, the good news is, for the first time in about 6 quarters, the Bulls showed that they could move the football and make a big play, so they can just file that back. Unfortunately, it sets up third down and 21. It's at the 43-yard line. This drive started at the 47. Blackwell under pressure, going deep again. Looking for Reuben again. Nearly picked off and nearly caught by Reuben at the 5-yard line.
Yeah, and that, you know what? That was a 3-deep zone, and Markwell never saw the safety sitting there and threw the ball right down. They're very fortunate this wasn't intercepted. You'll see it right here. He never sees the safety, forced a 3-man rush. Good job of Reuben, really, breaking up the interception.
Umholtz standing at his 42-yard line. He'll put it away, nearly loses it, and it's off the side of his foot. A very rare mistake for Umholtz.
Boy, this is coming all the way out to the 32-yard line. You're right, a tremendously rare mistake for Umholtz, because he was simply trying to get that ball to the coffin corner and just simply missed it.
One more look. You can see here has trouble bringing it down.
Yep, he has trouble getting the ball down, and then everything goes haywire from that point on. Boy, he's really, really been an outstanding player for this team this year.
Definitely the key in the victory over Illinois State, because he pinned Illinois State back in its own territory throughout the game. The pitch, Powell, the little guy, can't get back to the line of scrimmage.
And when you say little, you mean little.
I mean little.
5'4". 5'4". You know what? The perimeter plays are not going to be the answer tonight. Let's take a look. Here's the belly option with the front side guard pulling. Here's the pitch to the little guy. Mitchell, boy, and a host of others. Roy Manns.
Day with the quick pass. Washington very close to a first down. That's what's so frustrating when you're a defensive player against this offense. You play well for 2 out of 3 plays, and all of a sudden it's that third play where they come back and pick up the first down.
And that was a rare missed tackle by Roy Manns, because he really had him close to the line of scrimmage. That is very, very close to a first down. They're right on the sideline. Inches.
1:39 left to go in the opening period. The Wildcats with 82 yards on its opening drive. Randall Williams on a 9-yard touchdown pass from Ryan Day. And that's the scoring we've had here tonight. 7-0 New Hampshire.
Well, Al, you know, you had the very emotional victory over the number 6 team in the country last week. And, you know, you can kind of see it coming. You know, you just got a little bit of a letdown here against a very, very good football team. And Jim Leavitt, I've been talking to him this week. Believe me, he knew exactly what he had coming in here.
And this is a football team that checks in at 3-3, but we're talking a very difficult 3-3 day. Quarterback sneak.
Boy, you just don't like to give these guys opportunities like this.
It's good for the first down.
And now you're losing field position to them, which is very tough to get it. They're, you know, this team, they control the football offensively. Average 459 yards a game. You know, they average 28 points per game. I mean, they have been very, very efficient against everybody they've played.
Already 3 of 6 on third down. That is their average, 50% conversion of third down. And another flag is down.
South Florida's having a hard time getting lined up on this play. They got lucky.
It's against New Hampshire. Again, they came in averaging 10 penalties per game.
Yep.
Dead ball, false start on the offense. 5 yards previous spot, first down.
Well, that's the bad thing. You know, when you do run this offense, you're doing a lot of different things.
Let's go down to the field and Leah Secundo.
Well, after that first series, Al, when, as you mentioned, New Hampshire just marched right down the field in that no-huddle offense, 82 yards, Earl Lane and defensive coordinator Rick Kravitz got together with the team. They said, guys, you got to stay home. Don't take the bait. And they have stoned them on the last three series, only allowing New Hampshire just 17 yards on offense.
All right, thank you, Leah. Look at that, 82 yards on the first drive and only 18 yards since. But again, they've controlled the football for the most part. The Bulls have had their chances, but they trail 7-0 with 69 seconds left to go here in the first quarter.
That was a good job by Jay Mize on that throw in the flat.
Second down and long. Curran cuts it up, and he is hit by Brian Wilson just over the 40-yard line, not quite back to the original line of scrimmage.
Okay, we're looking at 3rd and 10 now. 3rd and 10. You'd like to think you got about a 80% chance defensively on 3rd and 10 of making a stop. That's normally the figure you'd like to have.
So far, New Hampshire, 3 of 6 on third down conversion. 39 seconds left to go in the first quarter. Day on the rollout. Tries to jump and he's nailed. The Bulls get a sack.
Well, that was a great job of Brian Wilson scraping off on the sprint out, reading the sprint out and scraping off for late contain. And boy, when he scraped off, he was serious about it. He didn't mess around. Got right up in the quarterback's face.
Kawika Mitchell also in on the sack.
Brian Wilson, a senior who's really stepped up big this year, having a heck of a senior year for South Florida.
By the way, that's only the 10th sack this season against this offense. And that's the end of the opening period. So when we come back for the second quarter, the South Florida Bulls will get the football on a punt. A beautiful night in Tampa, Florida. The Wildcats scoring their opening drive. And that's the only points we've seen so far. 7-0, New Hampshire over the South Florida Bulls. And the Bulls will get the ball on a punt here in the opening play of the second quarter. New Hampshire, again, scoring on its opening drive, going 82 yards before a good crowd here at Raymond James Stadium. The Bulls among the leaders in Division I AA, averaging some 25,000 fans per game. Randa Williams with the opening touchdown of the game. By the way, you can see Conference USA volleyball November 18th to the 21st at the University of South Florida. Call 813-974-3002. Some of the best college volleyball in the country. You'll see it there at USF. The Bulls looked like they were going to go for the block. Instead, they peel back. McLean, very high spiral. Charlie Jackson with the fair catch at the 30 and fumbles. But he gets it back. Looked like it hit him right in the helmet.
Yeah, and he just, somewhere it's up high, either helmet or the shoulder pads. And of course, you know, when you're a punt returner, He's been very, very good, but you've got to look the football in. You got to bend your knees with it. But this young guy punting now, he's had a pretty good night. Here, you see him right here. Let's see exactly what happens here. Yeah, just got him up high on the shoulder pads, and boy, those shoulder pads are unforgiving. That ball always comes off of him.
So the Bulls will get the football at the 32-yard line. Again, they trail 7-0. Bulls had a 32-yard touchdown pass called back because of holding cover. Blackwell tries to get away. He does. Under pressure. He's got a man wide open. That's the fullback, McMillan, near midfield. And that is one of the biggest gains offensively tonight for the South Florida Bulls.
Well, you know, you really don't want your quarterback running around like that, but that's what he brings to the table. That's Markwell Blake. He definitely can make plays and get himself out of some tough situations.
The game is to the Bulls 49-yard line.
Just a five-step drop. Nothing there. Some penetration up front. That's Raphael Williams blocking the outside backer, and that's a load to take on. Well, that's a terrific job by Blackwell. And McMillan coming back to the football, helping your quarterback out.
It's an 18-yard gain, and now the officials are discussing something where McMillan was brought down very close to midfield.
I have no idea.
I never saw a flag come down. South Florida doesn't want to give this back. Easily their biggest play offensively. Again, they had a 32-yard touchdown pass called back because of the cover. It looks like they're coming back to try to talk to the press box.
Yep.
And I know in recent games they've had problem with a fan having a whistle in the stands. And maybe this is something.
Now,
they can't be lining up the play here because, again, the referee is on. Is having a problem with his shoe. Blackwell on the run to the 40-yard line. It appears to be a first down. Now, what a crazy set of events here. The referee leaves the field. They continue to play, and Blackwell gets a first down.
I'll tell you what, he faked us out, that's for sure. I'm just like you. I thought he was going to the bench to get a call upstairs.
Looks like he's got a
cramp or an injury of some kind.
Near the calf area or the Achilles. From the 40. The Bulls with back-to-back first downs. Big hole, Raphael Williams at the 25, down near the 20.
It's always been amazing to me how you make one play offensively and all of a sudden it changes. Everybody's got a little bit lighter step to them. And now you're coming off the football and doing a heck of a job here. Here's Raphael Williams. This is running what they call, this is the slant play. Excellent block by McMillan. Jackson. Heck of a seam right there.
First down for the 22. Williams with a big game. With time, McCready at the 5 near the goal line. Tackle made by Mike Schwena.
It looks to me like the one play that Markwell made has really given him a dose of confidence and totally changed his momentum and his outlook. And this is surprising because let's take a look at it here now. This is very, very simple. Just a straight drop back pass, and he's going to run a straight curl. Let's take a look at it. Five-step drop, running the curl, running the back of the flat, wide open. The surprise is they're running so much cover three.
First and goal from the 2. Bulls looking for the answering touchdown. They trailed 7-0 since the opening drive. McMillan very close to the goal line. Touchdown, South Florida. Drive for the South Florida Bulls was a first down, and this is an offense that had been struggling for some 6 quarters. Umholtz to Tyus. And we are tied at 7. Opening drive of the second quarter. The Bulls answer the Wildcats of New Hampshire. Here at Raymond James Stadium on an absolutely beautiful fall night. The Bulls counter the Wildcats. We are all tied 7-7 thanks to Dyrell McMillan. The Bulls have an answer for New Hampshire. A 2-yard run by Dyrell McMillan, and the Bulls have tied it at 7. One more look.
That's a good crack in there. Boy, that's a 220-pound back lowering his pads. Good job.
And a long scoring drive, 68 yards. Every play on that drive was a first down for the South Florida Bulls. 68 yards in 2 minutes and 4 seconds. And Tony Umholtz to kick off for the South Florida Bulls. Very high kick. Jermaine Washington settles in at the 6-yard line. He fakes the reverse and he has a lane. Brian Wilson pulls him down at the 25-yard line.
Well, that's obviously the opening kickoff, same thing they did. Let's go down to Leah.
Well, gentlemen, Edward Ardito, the referee, told me that he either got hit by something down on the heel of his foot or he felt something pop. He really wasn't sure which it was. Either way, Mike Estes, the football trainer, taped him up just a little bit tighter around the ankles, and he's back on the field ready to go again.
All right, thank you, Leah. That happens a lot with a Achilles type of injury.
That's
you think something hits you, but really it's that Achilles just pulling. From the 26-yard line, first and 10. Handoff. This is Washington. Breaks one tackle. Takes it up over the 30-yard line before he's pulled down by Anthony Henry. And a good thing Henry made that tackle because Washington could have gone away.
Yeah, this offense, I mean, I'm just amazed watching it. It's really an old-fashioned offense. A lot of the plays are in terms of a lot of deception and everything else. It's not what you call modern football, but it still works, and it works very well.
Ryan Day, the quarterback for this team. Second in the Atlantic 10 in passing. Right up the middle goes back to, Kreider back in
back
for
in
the first
game.
Time since very early in the ballgame. And it appears he has the first down.
Now, this is a big 245-pound fullback here. This is just a simple trap. Actually breaks it outside the trap. And, you know, this is a guy who's also second on the team in receiving. Average 6.1 a carry. That's pretty good for a big back like him.
Now, when you talk over 240 pounds, he's bigger than two of the defensive linemen, starting defensive linemen for the South Florida Bulls. He is a load. Day hits Kreider. It's incomplete.
Now, that's the counterplay. Again, I'm really having fun watching this offense because they're doing a lot of things out of different formations. Let's take a look at this on the replay. This is the counter pass, faking the ball across the field and trying to get the big fullback in the flat.
Kreider last week, 18 carries for 184 yards for Sean McDonnell. That was his career high, averaging 10 yards a carry. Second down and long. Kreider again just bulls his way over the 40-yard line and a fumble. And the Bulls hoping to get the football, but it looks like New Hampshire, the only man in the neighborhood, that is Kamau Peterson.
Yeah, you know, this is a very fortuitous bounce here. Let's take a look at exactly what caused the fumble. He got hit on the way down. Ball definitely out.
That was Dan Curran, on the recovery. Another flag is down, sets up third down and 4.
Now, I don't know whether this is illegal substitution or they're going to, oh, there's a bench warning. It's a warning to the sideline to keep the coaches back. It's always a problem.
Third down and 4. 11:02 left to go here in the second quarter, Doug.
I always had a get-back coach telling everybody, get back, get back.
Day with time. Looking for Washington at the 45-yard line. Here comes the flag. It looked like Bernard Brown came over the back of the wide receiver, Jermaine Washington.
Well, he did, and I think this is a correct call by the officials. The home crowd disagrees, but pretty aggressive play. You got good corners and they're going to be aggressive. They're going to get penalties once in a while, but that was excellent coverage and just a tad early.
The second
Defensive pass interference. At the spot of the foul, automatic first down.
The second pass interference penalty called on the South Florida Bulls tonight. Jim Leavitt not happy with the call.
Well, let's take a look and see if we can, if timing-wise, he does make the contact before the ball is in. Now, that's close.
Tough play. So
that's really, that's a tough call.
Well, check out this formation. Four receivers at the top of your screen.
Here we go.
Looks like a train. Day has it knocked away, and the Bulls nearly pick it off. Thurman Edwards nearly intercepts the pass. Excellent defensive line play up front for the South Florida Bulls.
Is this offense wild or what? You know, and we have not seen Emory or Henry, either one of them, and we have not seen the Notre Dame box yet, but I bet we do. Pretty well covered downfield, really was.
Edwards does it all. Oh, he tips
really
the
does.
Pass and nearly picks it off from the 45-yard line, second down and long. You take away that opening drive, and the Bulls have controlled this offense. Kreider barrels his way to the 40-yard line. Boy, you know, you see this guy run, you see this guy walk on the field, and you see the big shoulder pads. You know, he reminds you of a guy playing tomorrow for the South, or excuse me, for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, one Mr. Mike Allstar.
Yeah, he really does, and he's a good, big, strong fullback that can lower and get those pads down. And, you know, this offense, they had a great player last year that's going to play on this field tomorrow. Jerry Azuman with the Bears played at New Hampshire. Walter Payton Award winner.
Third down and four. Another big third down play for this Bulls defense. Day with time. Hits a running back coming out of the backfield. Stephen Lewis.
That is going to be real, real close. I think it might be about a foot and a half short. I'm betting they're going to go for it again.
It is short.
Comes another tight end into the game. It's Ben Thompson, a freshman tight end.
By the way, opponents are 1 of 12 against the Bulls on fourth down this season. Fourth and less than a yard. Whoa, and the Bulls are right there for Kreider. When you have a fullback that approaches 250 pounds, you know he's going to get the football in a situation like this, and the Bulls are ready and waiting.
Marshall Smith with a huge, huge hit. And, you know, they've had such great success with the quarterback sneak. And, of course, now they've got a lineman down on the field, too. But what a great job by Marshall Smith. He's really stepped it up big since the injury to Jason Butler.
Well, looks like the Bulls took a page out of the Illinois State defense playbook by the run blitz. They were right there in the hole, ready and waiting.
Yeah, they
and
really
that is the fullback Kreider who carried the football.
Geez, he's so big, I thought he was a lineman. Boy, he really got rocked. I'm betting a right shoulder injury. I don't know. Let's take a look here. Watch the penetration up front. Great penetration. That was Williams that made the initial hit, and then Marshall coming in. Well, that's just great effort by the whole Bernard, Brown, Hatley, all of them. Great penetration. You know, again, with an offense like this now, oh, it is a knee injury. Looking at his right knee now, that would be a real blow to this team. Senior captain out of Mount Joy, Pennsylvania. He's had 425 yards rushing. There's Anthony Williams, made the big, big hit.
You think he's calling mom and say, Mom, did you see what I just did?
Well, I'll guarantee you mom's watching. But, you know,
9:56 left to go in the second quarter. The South Florida Bulls and the Wildcats of New Hampshire are all tied at 7. The South Florida defense has now held its opponents to 1 of 13 on fourth down. A couple of USF fans dressed up for this one. From the shotgun, Blackwell on first down. Hugh Smith wide open at the 40. And he has some speed. Pulls away from one tackler, and he is tripped up at the 39-yard line.
Well, I guess he has speed. 10, 400-meter guy, 4, 3, 140. They're very fortunate they were able to trip him up there.
John Oosterhaus with a touchdown-saving trip. Watch here.
That was a nice job of looking off down the field by Marquell Blackwell. Just barely, oh, boy, barely tripped him up.
Did you see the way he kind of shifted into fifth gear there when he just got outside? Beautiful play by Smith.
It really was.
From the 46-yard line, Bulls put the touchdown on their last drive, and Kenyatta Jones moving before the snap.
Well, there's nothing more embarrassing for an offensive lineman. I mean, everybody sees that. Obvious who made the error.
5 yards, previous spot, first down.
Jones, a junior out of Gainesville. He has been a regular part of this offensive line all 3 years here at the University of South Florida. And also played some basketball for Seth Greenberg when the Bulls were having some injury problems. Did a good job.
Big fella got up there, he got out there and mixed it up.
That's right. From midfield. First down and 15 for the Bulls. From the shotgun, Blackwell all kinds of time. Looking deep into triple coverage. Charlie Jackson cannot hold on. He wants a penalty, but the official says no way. Well, Eric Mitchell on the coverage.
This is a real surprise for me that because I looked at a lot of tape and they're basically a two deep zone team. And they've played almost exclusively three deep zone tonight. And I think that's a testament to the speed of South Florida, Al. That's exactly the way I read that. And a Marquell Blackwell, that's twice now. He has not read. He's misread the coverage from two to three deep because you don't make that throw down the middle against that coverage.
Second down and 15. Again, the shotgun. Blackwell with time. McCready has it in his hands, and he is just leveled by Jason Marshall. McCready knew he had to go up to make the catch, and Jason Marshall makes him pay for it.
Yeah, just a little bit high on the throw and getting the receiver up in the air. He's holding onto his back there. That doesn't feel too good.
That's enough to give you some alligator arms next time around.
Yeah, you certainly don't want to put your receivers in that kind of position.
By the way, coming up at halftime, we'll talk to a friend of Scott McCready's. His name is Tim Henry. He is our junior voice of the Bulls. His sister is engaged to Scott McCready. I'll tell you what, Tim is a big-time Bulls fan. Flags are down.
He's got the green and gold on the cheeks and everything tonight. He's dressed up ready to rock and roll.
And a great promotion by the Dairy Farmers. He gets a chance to interview Jim Leavitt. Chance to come here to the ball game and talk to the fans on radio and both on TV.
Always coaching.
And this will take the Bulls back even farther. They had to get to the 34-yard line to get a first down.
Well, you know, it all started with the penalty. I'm first and 10. Now you're first and 15. Now you're pitching him from behind right off the bat. Makes it tough to overcome.
Jim Leavitt saying, hey, everyone's talking to each other, but you're not talking to me. Tell me what's going on here.
Dead ball foul, delay a game on the offense.
I never saw the clock wind down.
No, I didn't either. Yeah, there's some kind of an error here with the 25-second clock operator or something.
Third down and a mile. Third down and 20. Bulls scored a touchdown on the last drive. They've been going backwards on this one. From the shotgun, seventh penalty for the Bulls. Blackwell. He's been able to make big plays when he's ad-lib, but not this time. How about that? Huge hits.
John Oosterhaus again. And that was a three-man rush with eight people in coverage, and that's tough to throw against. Best thing you can do is scramble around until somebody comes open.
Oosterhaus was not about to let him scramble for very long.
He's been impressive to me tonight. He's a good football player.
He's out of Canada.
Yeah, 6'4", 240-pound sophomore.
From the 24, Umholtz the punt. Powell back to receive. Umholtz gets it away this time. Beautiful punt. Fair catch for Powell. He takes it at the 25-yard line. 8:48 left to go in the second quarter. The Bulls with a 2-yard touchdown run by Darryl McMillan. New Hampshire, a 9-yard pass from Day to Williams, and that's your scoring tonight.
Yeah, and it looked like the series before that the South Florida offense had really finally got untracked, and then they came right out again and 3 plays and out again.
They hit one big play there to Smith on a screen, but other than that, they had penalties that took them right out of field position. From the 25, first and 10. Curran, and he is nailed at the line of scrimmage. For the most part, the Bulls have completely shut down this running game. It's a running game that came in averaging 236 yards per game.
Yeah, the Bulls defense has been absolutely spectacular tonight. Other than the opening drive, they have played terrific, terrific defense. They've gotten lined up properly. They've really shut down this New Hampshire offense.
New Hampshire went 82 yards on its opening drive for its only touchdown, and that was aided by a pass interference penalty on third down. Day with time, and he's looking deep again. And here comes a flag.
Well, that was an out and up on the sideline, and Anthony Henry knocked the running back right out of bounds, and I think it was before the ball was thrown. So that's what Jim Leavitt is so upset about.
The receiver, no way could the receiver have caught the football.
Flag to be waved off.
Well, that's a good call.
Pass was deemed uncatchable. Third down.
That's exactly right. Of course, you know, when you're standing on a bench, it's really not catchable. And Roy Mann's really knocked him right into the sideline. I don't know if we can see it here on this view or not. But look just to the left of your screen in the bench area. There's Roy Mann. And there's Jermaine Washington over there almost sitting on the bench.
You know what? Jim Leavitt could be a salesperson. He could be a salesman if he wasn't into this.
Well, they got a crack. Look out.
That's Washington. And he is on the run. He could go all the way. Touchdown. New Hampshire. 75 yards on third down.
Wow. Well, they really caught South Florida playing some coverage defense and hit him with the big crack. And boy, once you could just see it coming. I mean, once he cleared the 35-yard line, he was gone.
He's a wide receiver. Found a crack, got through the hole very quickly, and then it was lights out. The Bulls were completely out of position. There was no one there to even come close to catching.
And that's his 17th carry in this offense this year. So again, their wide receivers in this offense, they have to be able to do everything.
His third touchdown on the season. Carbonara now in to attempt the point after. And for the second time, the Wildcats put together a touchdown drive, and once again, the big play on third down. 75 yards for that man, Washington, on the touchdown run, and the Wildcats take the lead at 14-7. Far for the visiting team, New Hampshire, leading by a score of 14-7 as we get ready for the third quarter of action. South Florida coming in 5-2 on the season, rated number 17 in the country. The Bulls need this game to go on to the playoffs in Division 1AA. It's going to be like that the rest of the way this season. The Bulls, again, with losses to San Diego State to open the season, and also now the number one team in the country in Troy State. And the Bulls will get the football to open things up here in the second half.
Three-man booth here again, Al.
We will have, this is like Monday Night Football used to be.
Right.
That's right. We've got Tim Henry, who's going to join us. He's an 11-year-old from Plant City, the junior voice of the Bulls.
But you know what? I really like the chemistry of this team, don't you, Tim?
Back to receive for the Bulls. It'll be Charlie Jackson and DeAndre Rubin. A couple of players with a whole lot of speed. Back to kick off. Peter Carbonara. And the second half is underway. Rubin takes it at the 5. Has some blocking. One beautiful cut. Now cuts back the other way. He can go for a ways. Rubin with speed. Pulled out of midfield. Beautiful run by DeAndre Reuben. The Bulls have been desperate for big plays, and they finally have one here on the kickoff return. All right, Tim, tell me what you think of this.
He does a great job of breaking tackles and cutting back and forth and just running and just got knocked out of bounds there around the 50.
Coach, you're in trouble. This guy does a great job.
Another one trying to take my job.
He wants to use the telestrator next. Raphael Williams, nowhere to go. Eric Mitchell with a jarring tackle. And it looked like Williams had some room to run there. And the Bulls have a player down. The Bulls do not want that to be Raphael Williams. And it is. The Bulls are so short on running backs right now, Coach.
Yeah, they really are, and this would be just devastating because, and it looks like he might have got hit. This was might have been a helmet-to-helmet collision. This is a heck of a collision right here. That's what I thought, helmet-to-helmet. I'm betting he got dinged a little bit right there because that was a very, very violent collision.
As it is, Otis Dixon out for the season with a knee injury. Jermaine Clemens out last week with a knee injury. Yeah, they're down to Williams, Hugh Smith, and Daryl McMillan. That's basically it.
And they're very, very thin at that position, even to start the year. And, of course, Jermaine Clemens now, they're going to get him back, hopefully, in a week or two. But I'm sure that the way he's acting there, he got dinged a little bit. No question about that.
Jim Leavitt standing right over him.
Of course, LaFane Williams, who played running back last year, is really coming on strong as a corner, so you'd hate to interrupt his senior year and all of a sudden have to move him back. But if this is a injury that's going to keep Raphael out for any period of time, that's one of the moves you certainly have to consider.
LaFane Williams, a transfer last year from Pittsburgh, really had some big games in the backfield for the South Florida of the Bulls, and at that time the Bulls were so deep in their backfield they thought they could make the change and put LaFane on defense and give the Bulls more depth there because they didn't feel like they needed him on offense.
And it really was a good move for LaFane because he possibly could have a future as a cornerback. I mean, he's got the great speed, and it really, in the last couple weeks, he's really been coming on strong. So you hate to have to do that in particular to a senior, but as always, Tim, the team comes first. That's our first consideration, right?
Yep.
Now, Tim, you're 11 years old. You're from Plant City. You've played some Pop Warner football. Have you ever been nailed like that?
Yeah.
Really?
But it was in practice.
It was in practice. Tell us about it. Did you see stars and hear people talking to you, that kind of stuff?
No, I was just running I was playing running back like that, and I was running a ball, and my own player came up to block for me, and someone just knocked him right into me, and I just fell over and dazed for a minute or two.
Oh, man. And you were able to walk out the field, and you were all right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, the same appears to be true for Raphael Williams. He's going right to the bench. So another injury for the backfield of the South Florida Bulls. Second down and 10. Bulls trail, 14-7. Opening drive of the second half. Hugh Smith, right side. Plenty of speed here. He has a first down over the 30-yard line. Well, the Bulls may not need a whole lot of running backs if Smith has an open lane like that.
Yeah, he really caught him in a seam because they came on the blitz with the outside backer with a cover three deep zone behind it. We'll take a look at it right here. Big Joe Condren blocking down. Good block by Dyrell McMillan, which really is what, and look at the speed and the burst here to turn the corner. Young guy who's a transfer from Miami of Ohio.
And it's a 22-yard gain for Hugh Smith. First down and 10. They're changing the play at the line of scrimmage. Smith again, this time the left side. This time he cannot turn the corner. New Hampshire right there. Brett Bashaw with the original interference on the play. Frankie Smith finished him up. A loss on the play of a yard.
Yeah, and even Hugh Smith didn't have enough speed to really get that one to the sideline. Second and 11. Again, you really like to stay away from the negative plays in the running game. but because now that sets up a tougher situation.
Scott McCready at the top of the screen. You know this Scott guy pretty well, right?
Yeah.
Okay, you want them to go to Scott on this play, right?
Yes.
Scott, of course, is engaged to his sister, but they go back the opposite way. Reuben on the wide receiver screen. He's got plenty of room. Quick feed over the 20 to the 17-yard line, and even though they didn't go to McCready, you like that play?
Yeah, because they got some yardage on that one.
Good. They looks like they've got a first down as well, or very close to a first down. So the Bulls are on the move on this opening drive of the second period. Second half.
Tim, let's take a look at the replay here. You see a wide receiver screen with a lineman out front blocking. Missed block right there, but he got in the way. That's a good job of DeAndre advancing the football.
From the 18-yard line, first and 10. Bulls trail 14-7. Hugh Smith right up the middle over the 15. Another good gain on first down. Now the Bulls were able to do this late in the second quarter, but they got no points out of it, Doug Graber.
Yeah, exactly. And Al, this is very, very reminiscent of last week when they came out with a great drive when they came out of the locker room in the second half against Illinois State.
It's a gain of 5 on the play, second down and 5. Bulls have a 2-yard touchdown run by Dyrell McMillan in the second quarter. Here's McMillan with some room. Right down Broadway. Touchdown, South Florida.
Our guest analyst threw his hands up in the air signaling touchdown there, Al, when he was on the 5-yard line.
No doubt about it. Dyrell McMillan makes it look easy. Looks like nobody touched him. 14 yards for the touchdown, and the Bulls with the point after can tie things up.
Let's take a look at it here, Tim. This is the draw trap with Big Joe Condren coming around and trapping on the defensive end, and boy, there was just nobody there. Untouched.
We'll try to tie it. Tough snap. The snap was good, but the hold. Usry had to pull it in. Good play by Usry to get it down for Umholtz. And the Bulls have tied things up 14-14 here at Raymond James Stadium. Dyrell McMillan has been the workhorse tonight for the South Florida Bulls. He has a pair of touchdowns. Number 2 right here. This is what he sees.
Yep, there's the big man child, Condren, coming around. It's a tackle, draw, trap. Untouched. Well, we got a heck of a ball game now, and I'll tell you what, all these things have been kind of nail-biting affairs here recently, and this one promises to be the same.
2:36 on the drive, 14 yards on the touchdown run. Dyrell McMillan. Now, the last time the Bulls scored a touchdown, New Hampshire came right back. Washington, who scored the touchdown, the fake, and a flag is down. He's pulled down at the 11-yard line. Beautiful tackle by Julian Johnson, but a flag is down.
Yeah, and for the third time tonight, after this penalty has walked off, New Hampshire's going to start inside their own 10-yard line. This is going to be half the distance to the goal line from the spot of the fall. It should be about the 4 or 3.5-yard line.
New Hampshire backed up even further.
Yeah, and of course, and again, the game, that was a great kick, by the way, by Umholtz. I mean, I really didn't know he
during
had that
return,
much leg strength.
Illegal block in the back on the kicking team. Half the distance from the spot of the foul, first down.
First and 10 from the 4-yard line for the Wildcats from New Hampshire. Umholtz, a beautiful kick. He has pinned the Wildcats back in its own territory. The Bulls have tied it. It's Washington in motion. The same play they scored the 75-yard touchdown on. And this time the Bulls are ready. Bernard Brown, the tackle for the South Florida Bulls. It looked like that time, Tim, they were ready for that play.
Yeah.
Good answer.
Brian, Greg Walls is down right now, the young freshman from Sarasota Booker. And that's another position they've already lost. Let's see what happens to him here. He's getting blocked back on, just gets balled up. Can't really see what happened. Marshall Smith, and again, that's Bernard Brown coming in and making the tackle. But if Greg Walls is seriously hurt, that's a position they've already lost Ron Johnson for the season. And now you're playing two true freshmen there, and Greg Walls and Leroy Selman. and this would be another devastating injury for the Bulls. You know, when you're a 1AA team and really limited in your scholarships, Al and Tim, you just cannot afford to have injuries like this at the same position. That's really the crucial thing. Looks like he's getting off okay, though.
Wall 6'2", 285 pounds, the freshman from Sarasota.
He's lost 24 pounds from the start of the season. He's really a much different looking athlete right now than he was early in the year. That kid's really got a bright future here, Tim. He's going to be a good one.
Gain of 3 yards on the play. Second down and 7. Again, it's Washington, and again, the Bulls are ready.
Well, that was the wing T counter. Now, that's the first time we've seen the wing T counter play tonight. And a very, very good discipline on the defense of the Bulls right there. Okay, let's take a look at it now. You're going to see the quarterback open up this way, and here comes the counter play.
Roy Mann's among the tacklers for the Bulls. Big third down and 5. To the air. Day. Nearly intercepted after the ball was in the air. Kamal Peterson had it right in his grasp at the 20-yard line. Came loose. The Bulls were not able to pull in the tip. And it looks like, Tim Henry, the Bulls are going to get some decent field position as Sean McClain comes in for the punts.
Was that good defense, or did he just drop that ball, Tim?
A little bit of both.
Okay. A little bit of both. You know, you can
very
go
political,
politics as well. You know, you just don't have to be a sportscaster
hey,
here.
You got to call it the way you said. He dropped that ball.
Beautiful punt by McClain. Jackson with some room. At the 45, cuts it up. Runs into his own man, not the 40. The feeder's still going. Gets it inside the 35-yard line.
Great field position. Late flag.
Runs the ball back for the Bulls.
It is over near the 50-yard line on the opposite side of the field. A long ways away from the action.
If that's on that side, that can't be a clip. It's got to be a hold. Oh, it is a clip.
Again, it probably happened a good 15 to 20
that's a
yards
foolish,
away.
Foolish penalty. These are the ones that just drive you crazy as a coach. When you get a penalty with something that's not even involved in the play, Tim, really, really a foolish mistake. And here you got great field position here on the 34-yard line. Now you're going to give, this is probably going to be about a 30-yard penalty if you look at everything concerned.
During the return, illegal block in the back on the receiving team, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down.
And again, you could feel that momentum shift over to the South Florida Bulls, and that certainly slows things down here at Raymond James Stadium. 10:48 left to go in the third. We're all tied. The Bulls 14, the Wildcats 14. Welcome back to Raymond James Stadium. New Hampshire 14, South Florida 14. The last time the Bulls touched the football, they drove down for a 14-yard run from Dyrell McMillan, and we're tied at 14. Get your sports fix with Tampa Bay's number one sports station, WDAE, the sports animal. Start your day with Dan Cilio, followed by Chris Thomas, Jim Rome, and Steve Dooman. 1250, WDAE, the sports animal. From the 40-yard line, first and 10. The shotgun and the handoff to Hugh Smith. He turns the corner, left side, pulled down at the 45-yard line. Again, we're joined here in the booth by Tim Henry, an 11-year-old from Plant City. He is the junior voice of the Bulls in a contest put together by the Florida Dairy Farmers. Now, why did you decide to enter this contest here, Tim?
Because I enjoy watching the Bulls, and I like the Bulls, and I like milk, so I figured, what the heck.
Perfect combination. Nowhere to go for McMillan. He is hammered. Chris Robinson, the tackle, along with Mike Wells for the Wildcats. A loss on the play. Third down and long.
Well, again, finally, finally had a little bit of momentum, and now we got a third and seven here, and we need this conversion in a worst way for South Florida.
Third down and seven. From the shotgun. Blackwell with time. Scott McCready.
Yeah, go Scott.
Near the 40-yard line, and you're a Scott McCready fan, right?
Yeah.
Now explain to everybody why you're such a big Scott McCready fan.
Because my sister Erin is his fiance.
I see. Okay, now you call the replay here. Tell us what happened.
Blackwell's dropping back, and he's getting good blocking up front, and then he throws it out. Scott reels it in, and then fights for a couple extra yards before he's tackled.
All right. Good hands for the brother-in-law to be right there. Limping a little bit, but he'll be okay. From the 40-yard line, the Bulls are hoping they're on the move again. He scored a touchdown last time out. McMillan, right side, has some blocking. Beautiful block by Kenyatta Jones. And the Bulls have another first down. How about that pancake by Kenyatta Jones, Coach?
You called it out. That was a pancake. And I don't know if we can get a shot of this in the replay or not, but that was a devastating block by 308-pound Kenyatta Jones. Let's take a look. Watch him right here. He's going to pull all the way from the left side, number 74, leading the play. Bam! Right there. That's a decleater.
Two straight first downs for the South Florida Bulls. They're at the 28-yard line. Smith, another hole. Down to the 20-yard line, gain of 8 yards.
Well, the key play here is the third and eight conversion by, that was a heck of a catch by McCready too, don't you think, Tim?
Yeah, I like that catch.
Al Keck along with Doug Graber, joined in the booth by the junior voice of the Bulls, Tim Henry, 11 years old from Plant City. Here's Scott McCready. He's on the bottom part of your screen. McMillan cuts it back. The 10-yard line spins down to the 5-yard line. Another first down for the Bulls.
Well, that's the slant play that they run so well. And I'll tell you, McMillan has really been impressive tonight. Now, he's a little bit slow getting up.
The Bulls have already lost Raphael Williams. They were shorthanded as it was. Here's another look from the end zone.
Excellent combination block by Sip in particular. Hugh Smith, a block at the point of attack.
It looked like somebody stepped on his foot.
Yeah, he's looking okay coming off here. Just a little bit of a gimp. And really, Hugh Smith is really the only healthy human being left that they can put back there.
Raphael Williams left with what appeared to be a head injury. Hugh Smith now the only running back in the backfield. From the six, Smith keeps it.
Whoa.
Nobody touches him. Touchdown, South Florida. Six yards, right down Dale Mabry.
A young man from Merritt Island. Transfer from Miami, Ohio. 4-3-1, 40-yard dash. He shows some real burst.
Umholtz in for the very important point after try. And he nails it. 7:47 left to go in the third. The Bulls trailed 14-7 at halftime. They've come out with 14 unanswered points here in the second half, and the Bulls lead 21-14 at Raymond James. The South Florida Bulls with third quarter touchdown runs by Dyrell McMillan that tied the game at 14, and then a 6-yarder right here from Hugh Smith. Again, nobody touches him.
No, absolutely. That's the second touchdown tonight where the back has been absolutely untouched into the end zone.
Charlie Jackson had the biggest hit on the play. That was on the celebration.
Yeah.
3 minutes, 1 second on the drive. Umholtz kicks up, and this is a boomer. Powell takes it 5 yards deep in the end zone and simply goes down to an A. Beautiful kick by Umholtz.
You know, just as you'd expect with the difference in speed, the special teams have been a huge advantage for South Florida tonight. New Hampshire's had to start twice inside their 10-yard line with their kickoffs, and South Florida has been up to the midfield twice on their kickoff returns. That's a, you know, 80-yard difference right there in field position.
Umholtz, could it be five straight weeks of special teams player of the week in the Division I AA Independents? From the 20, first and 10 for the Wildcats of New Hampshire. The fullback, Class A Mark, ready for it.
And Vasse Mark is really an interesting story for this South Florida defense. A young guy out of Miami Northwest High School, hardly played. You know, this kid was from Haiti and really didn't play football until very late as a teenager, but he's really starting to develop into a heck of a player.
Gain of 3 yards on the play, second down and seven. Play action. They tried the screen pass to Lewis. And the Bulls did a good job of staying in their lanes there, Doug Graber. They weren't fooled by anything, and there was really nowhere for Lewis to go.
No, there really wasn't. And Williams, Anthony Williams and Roy Manns were right on the spot. Excellent discipline defense. And now here, this is amazing what they do here. They stay on the line of scrimmage. Let's take a look at the high end zone of this play on the middle screen. Just a bump right there. And here comes a Vasse Mark and Williams in on the tackle.
Third down and four. Day with time, hits his tight end. This is good for a first down. Mike DePalma, his first catch tonight. Good for a 10-yard gain and a first down.
Yep, 251-pound tight end. That's a huge target for Day. And you know what this offense does, it forces you to play vanilla on defense because of all the formations. So they were in a zone there and he just found the open spot and they get the ball to him.
Is there anybody on this football team that doesn't push 250?
Let's see, the quarterback is only about 210.
This is Peterson. He has another first down. So just like early in the ball game when the Bulls had an answering touchdown.
Yep, and here comes New Hampshire
here
back.
Comes New Hampshire.
And let's give them credit. They're coming back and they're certainly answering the bell.
They'll mark it at the 49. Ryan Day, the second leading passer in the Atlantic 10. He's only a sophomore. The Bulls have not been able to rattle him tonight. Curran.
Got a crack.
And he has a crack, and he could go. Roy Mann's trying to stop him. Pulls him down inside the five at the 1 yard line. So another big play on the ground. Deadly for the South Florida Bulls.
Yeah, and the safety, Anthony Henry, missed the tackle. That's twice on the slant now. And this power play, take a look at it here. You'll see number 12 coming in, and the ball is going to be kicked outside. Got a guard out in front blocking him. That's very, very well executed. And Curran is another 211-pound halfback. That's a good, solid football player.
A 50-yard run for Dan Curran. Number 3 in the Atlantic 10 in rushing. 4 on the play clock. Flags down. The pass is complete to the fullback, Baptiste, but this may come back.
Yeah, this is absolutely going to come back, and what a huge penalty this would be. Unless South Florida lined up offsides, that's the only thing I can, otherwise it has to go against New Hampshire.
12 men participating on the defense.
On the defense.
Penalty is declined.
Yep.
Touchdown.
So call it a touchdown for New Hampshire. Day on the 1 yard touchdown pass.
It's the Bulls 21 in the Wildcats.
To the fullback, Rowan Baptiste.
Well, that's, you know, you get your goal line defense in, and one of the defensive backs has to come out, and obviously there was a miscommunication.
Carbonara in to attempt the point after and tie the game. This was tipped, but it is still good. 5:37 left to go in the third. And an answer from New Hampshire. This Wildcat football team refuses to go away. This is a football team that comes from the Atlantic 10 Conference. Coming into this game, you're looking at 3-3.
after beating the number six team in the country. But this New Hampshire team, big, very physical, and Sean McDonald's team refuses to back down to anybody.
No, they don't. And, you know, but they've been a fine off. Of course, their coach McDonald's very upset about something here. He's got to get himself under control first. Rookie head coach, done a great job up to this point. You know, the three losses they've had, though, Al Keck, you know, they lost 34-19 to UMass, the defending national champ, 35-28 to James Madison, 27-17 to Richmond, who, of course, upset Hofstra, the number three team last week. So they've had three very tough losses, and they play in a good conference. So this is a heck of a challenge. And, of course, next week, South Florida has to go up and play at James Madison, who beat this team.
Huge game for the South Florida Bulls. There was some worry that the Bulls might be looking past this game to James Madison, but with all the injury problems the Bulls have had, they cannot afford to look past anything.
No, this is really trying to put a patchwork offense in particular now on the field with the two injuries tonight to the, and we have not seen McMillan on the sideline, but that's going to be crucial. He has to be able to come back tonight.
The two head coaches on the right, Jim Leavitt, on the left, Sean McDonald. And it was a short kick in the Bulls' recovery. If there's anything the Bulls needed right here, it is excellent field position.
Well, that's the third time tonight now that the Bulls have taken over near midfield because of the New Hampshire kickoff team. Coach, he's coaching all the time, all the time. There's a young guy there that hasn't played much football. And, boy, he's going to be a good one, though. Massey Mark.
Getting a big-time lesson right now. The Bulls are at the 49. Tied at 21. Hugh Smith hit hard, tries to fight forward, but Bashaw, the big hit for New Hampshire.
And, of course, that's one thing that Hugh Smith at about 170 pounds, you know, it's going to be tough for him to be a consistent inside runner. McMillan is back on the field. So that's crucial now for South Florida.
Second down and eight. Well, Tim Henry, the last time the Bulls were in a situation like this, they look for your buddy, McCready. He's on the field here at the bottom of your screen. You think they're looking for him again right here?
Let's hope so.
Let's hope so. Second down and eight. Play action. Blackwell in trouble. Tries to get away. Gets back to the line of scrimmage. Was one step away from taking off. Craig Robinson has made some big tackles tonight for the Wildcats.
Well, again, you know, he was looking for the post, but they had rotated late into a three-deep zone, and the post wasn't there. And you have to, you know, I got to emphasize their game plan. They were expecting mainly cover two tonight, and they're getting mainly a three-deep zone. So that really makes a lot of changes in your whole offensive attack.
Third down and eight. Three wide receivers. That's Anderson in motion. Anderson hit immediately. Well short of the first down.
Play pass complete to RJ Anderson.
Well, again, that's kind of a redshirt freshman mistake. You know, you definitely want to throw the football to get the first down. And he had no chance there.
A good 5 yards shy of the first down. Umholtz standing at his 40, he'll punt, or at least lining up to punt. Amon Powell back at the 10. At the very least, the Bulls are hoping to come out of this with a good battle in the field position. Very, very high punt.
The height on this punt.
Powell calls the fair catch at the 11-yard line.
Powell makes the fair catch.
And New Hampshire will take over from there. Log on to sportschannelflorida.com for the best in Florida sports. Send email to your favorite announcers, like Tim Henry. Link to professional and collegiate teams. And take part in interactive chats and polls. Here you go, Tim. You take the rest from here, okay?
Log on today, sportschannelflorida.com.
What a job. What a job. I'm in trouble, too, there, Doug Kramer. I hate these young kids that can do a good job, don't you, Coach?
Make it rough.
Yeah, we got to make a living, kid. Baptiste had the touchdown earlier. He's pulled down. Marshall Smith, the tackle for the South Florida Bulls. By the way, Greg Walls back in the football game. He left a couple of series ago with an injury.
Well, this is the second week in a row now that we're really into a gut-wrenching football game here. It's going to come right down to the wire. You can just see it coming. And of course, the Bulls really cannot afford to lose on their drive to be a 1AA playoff team this year.
Second down and 9. Here's Curran. Had a 50-yard run the last time he touched the football, but not this time.
Marshall Smith, Johnny on the spot, right there.
And now another injury for the Bulls. Bernard Brown on that big hit. And he was hit in the back of the head.
Well, that's a young guy that's really had an outstanding senior year up to this point. That would be a huge loss.
He's out of Jacksonville. Many times he's lined up against the number one receiver of the opposing team. How about that battle last week against Ricky Garrett?
Oh, boy, and I had a couple of pro scouts call me last week and ask me what I thought of Garrett, the big wide receiver for Illinois State last week. Boy, he was tough.
Let's go down to the field and Leah Secundo.
Well, guys, it's not the kind of hit you want to hear. You always want to hear have that good lick by the defensive player. But I'll tell you what, after that lick was made, there was a scream that just came out over the ball field. And right now they're down there. Mike Estes and the crew trying to work on the player and trying to get up. Oh, great. He's at least sitting up, but you could tell that twinge in his neck went right down to his feet.
Leah, have you heard anything on the other Bull players that are hurt? Raphael Williams, and of course, Greg Walls is back in the game. Dyrone McMillan has also been having some injury problems. Anything new on those players?
Well, Raphael Williams, I was standing behind him actually on the bench. They run through a group of tests, and basically he has to come up with the right answer of all the questions that they have over a certain period of time. Right now, they said Rafi's done for the night. However, they still will run through those questions to at least make sure that he gets them right.
All right, Leah Secundo down on the field, and Bernard Brown leaving very, very woozy. Again, he's out of Jacksonville. And again, he is very much out of it right now. The early word, by the way, on Williams, let's listen to this.
Yeah, that was a helmet-to-helmet, defensive player-to-defensive player. That was a...
And here comes New Hampshire out throwing. Boy, is Jermaine Washington had a living today against the South Florida Bulls. That on a third and long, again, the big play burning the South Florida Bulls.
And again, New Hampshire continues to be just a tremendous third-down football team.
2:12 left to go in the third. And they went right after LaFane Williams.
It didn't take long, did it?
A double reverse. Lewis over midfield. Bassey marked the tackle.
Well, this is a very, very frustrating offense to go against. You're seeing, again, play after play after play that you haven't seen before. And it's tough to adapt to. It really is. Frankly, I really like this offense.
Second down and 6, just over midfield. We're all tied at 21. Day under pressure and simply throws it away. Thurman Edwards all over him. And there's a flag down.
This is in the area of a possible, no, illegal formation. That's offensive coordinator Chip Kelly trying to figure out exactly what happened.
Ineligible man downfield against the offense is declined. Third down.
Sets up third down and 6. If I were Jim Leavitt, I'd never want to see this team in third down. They are so dangerous on third down. Seven of 14 on third down, and that's their average for the season, 50%. Lewis in motion. Here comes Brian Wilson, and they get it out to the wide receiver, Peterson. It is incomplete, but the blitz by Brian Wilson really made Day nervous.
Yeah, it really did, and of course, he's unblocked, and that was exactly the lane that he had to throw through, Al. And watch Brian Wilson coming right here, unblocked, and he's got to throw right over the top of him, and that's, he just can't get enough on the football.
This sets up fourth down. Charlie Jackson back at the 10-yard line. Brian Wilson with the big play defensively, holding this team on third down. And we have a timeout called by New Hampshire. They're calling it a stinger there for Bernard Brown, and stinger, maybe putting it mildly. If you heard that hit.
Yeah, and that's really always one of the biggest worries, and that's really where a lot of the injuries occur when you're playing real good defense and running the football, and the back ducks at the last second. You have two defenders collide, and that's where really a lot of the defensive injuries occur.
And these days, with all the talk about blows to the head, one more look at this.
This is Brian Wilson. Here's Bernard Brown coming in. There's the back ducking, and here comes Wilson up over the top. Wow. Those are scary collisions right there. That was a violent collision.
Steve Young, of course, of the 49ers, trying to decide if he can continue on. A lot of talk about him retiring after head injuries. There was a high school football player recently that died, 15 years old, from a concussion, 3 days after the original hit.
Doing a lot of research with different materials for helmets, and you sure hope they can come through with some kind of a breakthrough.
From the 49, McLean back to punts. Charlie Jackson standing at his 10. And this is off the side of his foot. Bad punt, and the Bulls will come out of this pretty well when you consider they give up a long play on third down. They'll get the football inside the 30-yard line. 1:14 left to go in the third. The Bulls with two touchdowns. The Wildcats with an answer. Back down to the field and Leah.
Well, thank you very much. One of the key cogs on defense, linebacker spot, filling in for numerous injuries that the Bulls have had thus far this season, is number 44, Vassie Mark. He's been on a number of plays, both pressuring quarterback as well as coming in with some key tackles. Vassie Mark has 4.5 speed, NFL quality quickness. He's got the heart and the body, and Jim Leavitt's going to hopefully find it so that hopefully he'll have that pro career.
Thank you, Leah. The run on first down by Darryl McMillan. It's a gain of 4 yards for Jim Leavitt.
Second down and 6.
52 seconds left to go here in the third. The Bulls sorely need to put together a long drive here to regain the lead. Second down. Reuben on the wide receiver screen. He's got a first down and much more. Boy, what a tackle by Jason Marshall.
Yeah, that's a touchdown-saving tackle, no question about it. Jason Marshall, young guy from Piscataway, New Jersey. That's the town of Rutgers University. I've been, spent a few years up there.
That's right.
This has really been the best play offensively that we've run tonight, the wide receiver screen. And again, you like the matchups, trying to get the guy, the speed of South Florida out in space.
First down at the 45-yard line. Hugh Smith tripped up, keeps his balance, takes the big hit head-on from Wade Rocliffe, but it's still a good gain on first down.
This has really been a physical football game tonight. Lots of big time hits. Big strong team from New Hampshire. Watch this hit right here.
Bam!
Man, I'll tell you what, there's no place for the faint of heart out there tonight, Tim.
3 seconds left to go in the third quarter in a tied football game. Charlie Jackson in motion. Smith again, make that look. McMillan, all kinds of room. Beautiful cut. Dropped down at the 22-yard line on the final play of the third quarter. Darryl McMillan already with two touchdowns on the day. huge gain. And the South Florida Bulls head into the fourth quarter on the move. We'd like to thank Tim Henry, the junior voice of the Bulls, for joining us in the third. The Bulls and Wildcats tied at 21. Well, Coach, we talked about it in the open. We expected a physical football game. We expected a close football game. And we have that. Dyrell McMillan has meant everything to the Bulls so far, approaching 100 yards in the game.
Yeah, that was the inside zone play, and that was very, very well blocked up front. Corey Porter just missed the block on the right corner.
McMillan with 98 yards rushing so far tonight. Opening play of the fourth quarter. Bulls, Wildcats tied at 21. From the 22, first and 10 for South Florida. Again, the running game. Beautiful spin by McMillan, but he's tripped up as he gets to the 20-yard line.
That was a rundown blitz by New Hampshire. Unblocked free agent coming off the corner. They couldn't handle it. And really, they were fortunate to get a one-yard gain out of that. Good job by McMillan. And, man, I'll tell you, another gut-wrenching fourth quarter. No question about it.
Every game so crucial right now for the Bulls. At 5-2, they're hoping to make the Division I AA playoffs. But they have a tough, tough schedule. Next week, it's off to James Madison. Play action. The rollout, Blackwell. Gets away from the man, gets a block, and gets it up basically to the line of scrimmage.
You know, I think in that situation that Markwell had predetermined in his own mind that he was going to run the football on the boot, but because he had a receiver open in the flat. And really, if you read the defense, it says make the throw to the flat. Again, a young player, a lot of times that's, you know, they just do that. They just, okay, I'm going to do it, and they forget to make their reads.
The Bulls are 2 of 10 on third down. A crucial play here. From the 20. The blitz. Blackwell gets away, looking in the end zone. R.J. Anderson, touchdown, South Florida.
Wow. That is a great throw by Blackwell going to his left, Al, getting his shoulders turned all the way around. Great flexibility, and puts one right between the 8 and the 2. Terrific, terrific throw. Athletic play. Made a guy miss. Well, it just has a wealth of talent. You can just see it coming out.
R.J. Anderson, 19 yards on the touchdown. You're talking his third touchdown in two games.
Big extra point.
Umholtz makes it look easy. One more look. Blackwell.
Great athleticism here. Unblocked outside rusher coming. Easy to make him miss. Look at that throw.
13:32 left to go in the contest. The South Florida Bulls take the lead by 7, 28-21 over the Wildcats of New Hampshire. We're back in Tampa, Raymond James Stadium. South Florida on the 19-yard touchdown pass. Markwell Blackwell to R.J. Anderson. Tony Umholtz ready to kick off for the Bulls. Again, a very high, a very deep kick. Powell takes it at his 2. Again, fakes the reverse. And the Bulls nail him. Alvin Salter, the tackle for South Florida.
The Bulls kickoff team has had a spectacular night tonight.
Here's a look at the scoring drive for the South Florida Bulls. Again, the touchdown pass, Blackwell to R.J. Anderson. 7 plays, 72 yards. And they needed a long drive like that for 2 reasons. Number one, they take the lead. Number two, they get some confidence.
Look at this hit right here on the sideline by Salter. Well, that's Marshall Smith.
Marshall Smith sees an awful lot of action on the defensive side as well from the 19. Curran, we haven't seen him for a while, has a long run earlier tonight, and he's on the run again. This New Hampshire team refuses to go away.
You know, and another apparent injury that we've missed, we have not seen number 31, Jay Mize, since early in the game. And that has really been a huge loss to the South Florida defense, too. He's been battling a shoulder injury. And, you know, we're used to seeing him come up and fill on those plays and make those tackles.
First down from the 41. The fullback had nowhere to go, and he simply barreled his way over Basse and Mark to get a decent gain on first down. It looked like it was going to be a loss. He turned that into a five-yard gain, almost 6 yards, to the 46-yard line.
It's a pretty darn good job by a backup fullback at 230 pounds. Pretty good feet outside, backup field. You know, we have not seen their starter, Kreider, since early in the game as well.
Washington has been so dangerous tonight.
Here we go.
And here he goes again. Leaps over one player, pulled down at the 40-yard line. Washington already with the 75-yard touchdown run. He has a 50-yard catch on third down and has another big run there for the first down. 155 yards from scrimmage tonight for Washington. He has been deadly, especially on third down.
He really has. And that guy's just a football player. He runs well, he catches well, he does everything good. Young guy out of West Milford, New Jersey. That's a small town up in North Jersey.
Play action, Day. It's a wide receiver coming out. Big tackle, Roy Manns.
It's a completion.
Randall Williams.
For no gain.
Williams had a touchdown earlier in the ball game. In fact, on the opening drive.
Well, you know, this offense for New Hampshire is just relentless. You can see why they're averaging 28 points a game.
And they're averaging some 460 yards in offense a game. And they would certainly be approaching that tonight when you think about all the big plays they've had. Lewis with Rowe. Lewis on the run. That's a mark. Knocks him out of bounds inside the 15-yard line.
Boy, and that off-tackle power play is the play that has just killed them tonight. Absolutely killed South Florida. They've had three big plays off that tonight. Of course, that was the same play, the 75-yard run to Washington. And, you know, you've got to get your inside-out force here by the safety. But, you know, they're getting the tackle all the way through on the safety. And when they do that, boy, you're in trouble.
14-yard line, make it the 13.
Pass, throw
back. Could be going back to the quarterback, who's open. Day, close to the goal line, fights his way. And it looks like he's brought down just shy of the goal line. Beautifully conceived play. We expected this from this team. And a lot of times, just basic sandlot football. Draw it in the dirt and make it work.
Draw it up in the dirt and just run it. No problem.
Brian Millett on the pass, and there's Day.
And that is a wide receiver. Sometimes this team has had three quarterbacks in the game at once.
Quarterback sneak, touchdown for New Hampshire. And once again, in fact, like they have throughout this game, every time the South Florida Bulls make a score, the Wildcats come right back immediately to counter.
Yeah, and they're a hot team right now. They've won their last two games in a row. And they're very hot offensively, and that now they're at their average, 28 point. If they can get this, they're at their average for the season.
Day on the quarterback sneak.
Recent wins were against Stephen F. Austin, who was ranked 21st at that time in Northeastern last week.
Carbonara into attempt the point after. And it's good. 11-18 left to go in the contest. You won't want to go anywhere because we thought this would be a wild one. It's living up to all the hype. A long drive for New Hampshire, the 1 yard run by Day. We're all tied at 28.
You're watching Sports Channel Florida. Due to time constraints, we now move ahead in this presentation.
Like a missed field goal last week by Illinois State in the final seconds.
Yeah, it really does. He's just simply going to miss it to the left here. Not by much, but that's enough. Very difficult to be a punter and a kicker at the same time. Very, very difficult. Trying to fill in for Gramatica.
From the 20-yard line, quick pass. Washington, who's been so dangerous tonight, gets a 5-yard gain on first down. Washington already has a 75-yard touchdown run and a 50-yard catch on third and long.
Yeah, he's had a big, big night. And here comes the no-huddle offense again.
7:26 left to go in the contest. We're tied at 28. Washington again. And he is knocked down. Big hit, Sean Hay, along with Hatley.
Yeah, Roy Mann's a good fill on the, really, he's the one that forced the play. But, okay, third and three. 7 minutes left. Boy, the clock running, too. This fourth quarter is just flying.
It's been a long game overall. We've had quite a few injuries in this game that have slowed things down. But here in the fourth quarter, the clock has been moving. Third down and three. The fullback.
I don't think so.
Very short. And a look, good yard short.
And Bernard Brown is back in the game.
Oh, that is hard to believe.
That is amazing coming back after that hit. Yeah, no question about it. Here comes the punter on the field.
Anthony Henry back to receive for the South Florida Bulls. This will be his first try at returning a punt tonight. Sean McClain, who has been so impressive for the Wildcats, standing at his 15. 6-10 and counting. He has trouble with the snap, nearly blocked by the Bulls, but he still gets it away. Look at this bounce.
Oh, boy.
Sean McClain should go buy a lottery ticket. He's got about an hour.
They came out of that smelling like a rose, didn't they?
They sure did. They were whistling by the cemetery on that one.
Yeah, they were just fortunate that South Florida did not have a block on him. He just flat dropped it and somehow got it away.
Steve Hatley nearly got to it.
Yeah, he's the one that's just trying to force it. Wow.
The Bulls have it at the 29-yard line, first and 10. 5:55 left to go in the contest. We're all tied at 28. The Bulls missed a field goal the last time they had the football. Blackwell with time looking deep. McCready intercepted.
That's Sueda, and that was a great play by the captain. I mean, he played it exactly the way the corner has to play it. And Markwell needs to throw the ball just a little bit further outside. Well, that was, you know, you just had to think there was going to be a turnover here at some point. Unfortunately, it went to the wrong team for South Florida. Great job by Sueda. Take a look at it right here. You watch Sueda here to the right of your screen. Just want to throw the ball outside a little more. That's very well played by the right corner. Left corner.
At the 42, first and 10. Lewis over the 45. Now the South Florida defense has spent an awful lot of time on the field here in the fourth quarter. And with the way this offense can just pound you and pound you and pound you, you seem to take a pounding and then all of a sudden they break one.
All those big, big, big bodies leaning on you all night long, and it really does take a toll.
And right now New Hampshire without its top guns in Kreider and Curran. It's been Lewis, it's been Baptiste. And this guy, Washington, but he's caught behind the line of scrimmage this time.
Thurman Edwards, I'm sorry, Williams. Full run blitz, great penetration. They happen to catch him in the counter play coming across the formation. Penetration kills him. Take a look at it right here. Well, he got blocked by the center, got up off his feet, still made the play. That's a great effort by Williams.
Third down and eight. This team has been so dangerous on third down tonight. Two touchdowns coming on third down. Play action. Dead. Has his receiver. Good for the first down at the 3-yard line. What a catch by Brian Mullette.
Well, again, you know, the style of offense forces you to play zone. You have no way to match up your man against all that formation and everything else. And then they know that they're going to get a lot of zones and the curls there on the key third down.
4:25 and counting. New Hampshire on the move at the 45-yard line. Lewis in motion. Again, play action. They're looking for the screen. The Bulls smelled it, but they get it out to Washington, and it's a loss on the play. Big hit, Roy Manns.
You know, and this is exactly the time that a team like New Hampshire, you get a little bit antsy as a coach. They do so many wild and crazy things. You know, 4 minutes to go here in the game. Is this when you're going to get the Embry and Henry or some of these other, the Notre Dame box play? What are you going to get?
8 of 17 on third down and a timeout.
Yeah, in South Florida, again, had a substitution problem trying to get their nickel defense on the field. It's tough to do, and that's why they go that no huddle, because you cannot get your personnel groupings matched up properly.
Both teams still have two timeouts remaining in this half.
That's offensive coordinator Chip Kelly on the sideline, getting the quarterback and getting the whole team. Now, see what they'll do here, Al. They have their whole offensive football team on the sideline. Now, you know, you're the defensive coordinator. Who is going to end up on the field? Is it going to be four wide receivers? Is it going to be three tight ends? What's it going to be? And you don't know. You don't have enough time to make a change. So you just have to put your normal personnel out there and try to match up as best you can.
Come on, boss.
Absolute nightmare game for Jim Leavitt and defensive coordinator Rick Kravitz. Very, very tough to get everything matched up. And you know, in college football, you really have very limited practice time to prepare for the different styles of offense.
Look at this. New Hampshire came in averaging about 450 yards per game. They're on track for that. South Florida with 404 yards of offense. They only had 150 last week.
Yeah, they only average about 200 and... 60.
Second down and 11 from the 46. Here comes the blitz. Dave's able to get away from it for now. Takes off. He's pulled down very close to the 45-yard line. Maybe a gain of 2 yards on the play. But a good call defensively for the Bulls.
That was. And here we go, Al. Another third down. Pretty good athleticism right here. By Day. He stepped out of bounds right there.
Third down and 9 from the 44. Huge third down play. 8 of 17 so far in the game on third down. Quick pass, it's tipped, and the Bulls have it. Brian Wilson at the 40-yard line. 3:55 left to go in the contest. The Bulls get a break.
Wow. You know, the throw was there. If that doesn't get tipped up, boy, they're in business. They have what they wanted. They caught him in a blitz. Let's take a look at it. Full sprint out to the left. Good job. Oh, that's a great job by Sean Hay. Terrific job by Brian Wilson, the senior. Huge play for the Bulls.
From the 40-yard line.
Boy, this is a situation where you sure wish you had Gramatica healthy.
Under 4 minutes, 3:54 left to go. Tied at 28. Smith, can he turn the corner? Too much speed. Bashaw, the tackle for New Hampshire.
Hugh Smith, with all his speed, is this Gramatica trying to warm up?
Gramatica did dress for the game. I did not see him kick before the game. He's trying to get loose. I would think if they get it inside 40 yards on a field goal try, maybe he has enough to give it a go.
Well, both kickers are loosening up. Of course, Jim Leavitt, if they do get in position to try a field goal to win this football game, will have to make a crucial decision.
He's putting on the kicking shoe.
That's John Chiba serving with a smile on his face, saying, yeah, get those shoes on. Let's go.
You know, it's kind of like the gunfighter that his, you made him too mad. Yeah. You know, it's one of those things. He's now starting to get the holster ready.
Well, You know, I don't know, that's a tough decision as a coach because, you know, there's a young guy that hasn't kicked in a couple of weeks, you know, and of course, you know, Umholtz, he looks great on the extra points. It just looks like he gets a little bit flustered when he gets into the field goals.
By the way, that was Bashaw that made the tackle. Very slow getting up. He'll go over to the sidelines.
Boy, this is a game, if somehow you could just survive, this really is a game of survival. I mean, just trying to get to, it's been a very, very physical affair. A lot of injuries, both teams, very hard played, hard fought football game, very physical.
And we knew that coming in with this big football team from New Hampshire, very physical. Smith over the 40.
Sets up another crucial third down situation. Nickel defense coming in for New Hampshire. Huge call for offensive coordinator Chico Canales for South Florida. Huge call.
Third down and eight.
Two backs in the backfield.
The Bulls 3 of 13 on third down.
Let's look. Let's look. Here it comes. Oh, they pulled out. Late.
Blackwell. He's been able to do this all night. Can he do it again? Blackwell, very close to a first down, I believe. No, what a strange mark here. It looked like he got over the 50-yard line, and now it's very close.
Yeah, it really did, and this sets up a crucial call for Jim Leavitt. And I think that you really have to consider how good New Hampshire is on offense. I say you have to go for it here simply because you don't want to give them the football. Let's take a look at the spot here now. It was a delayed blitz. He's got great vision to seize it. Let's see where this.
Oh, that was a very good mark.
Yes, it was. His left foot just touched. I mean, that was a perfect mark by the official. Let's give them some credit. Looks like based on that replay, he's about
a half yard short.
Exactly.
You
I'd say about 8, 10 inches short. Let's see. Closer than that. Well, I think you have to go for it here. I really do.
You're at the 50 yard line. Your defense has been able to make big plays throughout the evening. 2:34 left to go. And there's a look at Gramatica warming up.
Wow. This would be some story. I wonder if Coach Leavitt knows that he's warming up over there. This guy is, you know, you wouldn't have, you can't think of anybody else you'd rather have kicked than him. Okay, now the key here is get lined up, don't be offsides, don't make a mistake. I'd like to think we're going to get quarterback sneak here.
And there it is, and it's a first down. 2:31 left to go in the contest.
Boy,
we're tied at 28.
What a ball game.
McMillan, touchdown runs of 2 and 14 yards. Hugh Smith, a 6-yard touchdown run. And Blackwell has a 19-yard touchdown pass to R.J. Anderson. 28-28. From the 49, 2:17 and counting. Smith, again trying to turn the corner, cuts it up. Gets a yard or two before he's pulled down. Wade Rowcliffe.
Trying to get the groin loose. Boy, how many key plays can Marquell Blackwell make tonight here in the second half in particular?
Especially on third down. We're under 2 minutes. The Bulls taking their time. Quick pass, the screen. To Scott McCready, he is short of a first down with 1:31. And I would think the Bulls, with two timeouts remaining, are going to think about taking a timeout sometime.
I'm really surprised they didn't take one right here.
Third down and 5 for the Bulls.
Clock's still running.
Third down and 5, 1:14 left to go. In a situation like this, could Jim Leavitt be thinking about overtime here?
Well, it absolutely could be. And of course, you know, the overtime rule in college football is exciting stuff.
Third down and five. Swing pass. Smith, looking for McMillan. That's incomplete. 53 seconds. Fourth down and five.
Fourth down and five.
Now, in a situation like this, if you've let the clock go down like you have with 53 seconds, do you punt the ball away?
Yeah, I think it's a no-brainer. I think you have to punt the football away right here. There's no question. You cannot give that potent offense of, if you don't convert it, you just cannot give them the football near midfield.
Umholt standing at his 42. Powell at his 10 to receive. 53 seconds remaining. Two on the play clock. They get it off just in time. A very hot punt. This is going to be very close to the goal line. Chivas inside the five with 42 seconds remaining. This offense will have to go some 98 yards to get the touchdown and a long ways to go for the field goal.
But now you just need to play good, solid defense right here. I would think they're going to end up in a three-deep zone. Keep everything inside of you. I worry about their, frankly, you know, you worry much more about them breaking a big play in the running game than in the passing game. I mean, that's really been the trend tonight.
And they've been able to do that. Remember, they have a 75-yard run from Jermaine Washington. 42 seconds. The fullback, Roy Mann's on the hit. Barely able to get to the 5-yard line. And we have a timeout called by South Florida.
Well, you're hoping that they're going to make some kind of a mistake down here. You'd love to have them punt the football from inside their 5-yard line.
36 seconds remain. We're tied at 28. Well, we had a knee knocker last week.
Yep.
Another one this week.
And it certainly would appear that we're headed to overtime. Not much question about that.
Six seconds remaining, tied at 28. New Hampshire opened the scoring on its opening drive on a 9-yard touchdown pass from Day to Randall Williams. The Bulls answered in the second on a 2-yard run by McMillan. Then just before halftime, Jermaine Washington takes it 75 yards for the touchdown. 14-7 New Hampshire at halftime. From there, McMillan on a 14-yard run. Smith on a 6-yard run. 21-14 Bulls. Again, New Hampshire answers to tie it at 21. And then on the opening drive in the fourth quarter, Blackwell with the 19-yard touchdown pass to Anderson. Day answers on a quarterback sneak. And there you have it, 28 apiece, 36 seconds remaining. Second down and eight. Curry near the 8-yard line before he's pulled down. Well, 28 seconds.
You know, and that was an arm tackle away from going out the gate. And that's, again, the problem with this offense. Jim says, I've had enough of that. No more timeouts.
Now with 15 seconds left to go. So it appears these two teams are headed for overtime. And when we get to the overtime, there is a new rule, or at least new last year, on overtime. And we'll have to talk about that to see what all this means.
Now, the coin toss for overtime really becomes a key play, you know, to see who can go on defense first, because then you can, you know what you have to do to win.
And that's the end of regulation. The Bulls, 28. The Wildcats, 28. We're headed to overtime. Don't go away. We're live at Raymond James. We expected a wild football game. Doug Graber, we have that. 28 going to overtime.
Well, you know, the funny thing is New Hampshire hit their scoring average right on the button. They averaged 28 points a game, and they got it. Now, the overtime strategy here in college, I love the college football overtime rule where both teams, really, the key is the coin toss here. What you would like to do is win the toss and play defense. Then, because it's, both teams are going to get a possession here on the 25-yard line. And that from that point, you just play the game.
And the reason you want to play defense first, so you know what you have to do.
Yeah, for example, if the other team doesn't score or has a turnover or whatever, then you think if you have a great kicker, you want to get your kicker on the field and hopefully win the game with a field goal. Don't even have to mess around. You know, on the other hand, if they score a touchdown, then you know you have to score a touchdown. If they get a field goal, then obviously a touchdown to win. So you know what you have going.
By the way, there is Kreider.
He's obviously
in the warm-up suit.
He's done for the night, which we knew early.
Schweda is the other captain for New Hampshire. Joey Sipp and Anthony Henry for South Florida. He called heads.
They also, you know, again, have to decide what side of the field they prefer. Really, tonight, no wind.
No wind to speak
of. Nothing. No real, no advantage there.
So the Bulls win the toss. They decide to go on defense, right?
Yes. Yep.
So they did exactly what you told them to do, Coach.
Yep, and that's a good decision. And then I'll tell you, but there is one little thing here. That means that New Hampshire is going to be going on offense right into the South Florida band and the loud section. So that's a slight advantage there on their audibles.
Here's a look at the scoring summary from tonight. We've had a fun ball game, expected to see some points. We have certainly done that. Again, it all started with Randall Williams on a 9-yard touchdown pass from Day. I mean, it's 7-0. From there, the Bulls answer in the second quarter. Tyrone McMillan tied it at 7. Just before halftime, Washington on a 75-yard touchdown run that gave New Hampshire a 14-7 lead. From there, McMillan tied it up. Smith with the 6-yard touchdown run to give the Bulls the lead. Again, New Hampshire answered. Blackwell gave the Bulls a 28-21 lead. And again, New Hampshire answered. From the first play of overtime, Day has Millett's inside the 15-yard line.
And again, that's what that offense does to you. It forces you to play zones, and then they know they can kind of hit the curl in there if the backer can't get enough depth to get under it. And with the play action, it's very difficult to do.
And again, you would think at this point, at the very least, New Hampshire is in field goal range.
Yep, sure would.
From the 12, a blitz for the Bulls. Lewis gets nailed. Roy Manns. A loss on the play of 2 yards.
Boy, Roy Manns has really had a great year for South Florida. He's a tough, physical, hard-nosed player. Second and 11 now.
It'll be second down and 13.
Umholtz now warming up. Again, earlier we saw Gramatica. And Gramatica is still on the sidelines. Doesn't have a helmet on, but he does have his kicking shoes on. From the 15. Second down and 12. Quick pass.
Oh boy.
Baptiste. Touchdown.
Got flags. 3 of them.
And the Bulls are claiming they were held.
Now that's coming back. No question about that.
Remember, the Bulls had a long touchdown pass called back because of a penalty very early in the contest.
They caught him in a blitz, and somebody blew the coverage because the fullback was totally uncovered in the flat.
Block in the back.
Yep. That's going to set up second and very long.
And again, it makes you wonder if this will take them now out of field goal range. No, it probably will not.
Illegal block in the back above the waist. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Still second down.
So they'll mark it at the 15-yard line. Basically, this was the line of scrimmage moments ago.
Boy, and the kicker has become such a key thing in this situation. The Carbonara is 5 of 6, and of course, we're without Gramatica.
He's long. 37 yards. Play clock winding down. 8 seconds. The Bulls in a blitz. Quick pass.
Very well defensed by Glenn Davis. He got it. They were trying to throw the fade, and he just stuffed the wide receiver, and it took him totally out of the route, totally out of it.
Third down and long, and again, throughout this game, New Hampshire has made a living on third down.
Well, huge, huge play.
From the 15. Third down and 13. Day with time. Malak, touchdown.
Boy, what a catch. What a throw and what a catch. That was very well covered.
Three Bulls were in the neighborhood.
That was Glenn Davis on the coverage. He really had tight coverage, but that was a great throw and catch.
Well,
now the extra point now is really huge here.
Carbonero, perfect tonight, 4 of 4. He has missed two on the season.
Chivas is the leaper.
And it's good.
And the kick is good. It's the Wildcats.
So on round one, advantage, New Hampshire.
Well, you know, watch Chivas here. Boy, what a great vertical leap he has right up over the top of the center. And wow.
That would be intimidating.
Yeah, I would think so. If I was a kicker, that would make me a little nervous. Right up on the back of their offensive center.
Who needs a chiropractor these days when Chivas is around?
Yeah, the timing was just a little bit off on it. He really did get there just a tad too soon, and of course they may have bobbled the snap a little bit too. Okay, now a clear cut mission here. You've got to put it in the end zone.
The Bulls will have to score a touchdown. Smith, very little running room.
It really looked like he just stumbled. Looked like he had a crack.
Bash on the tackle.
It's a young guy that hasn't played much this year. It's an awful crucial situation for him to be in.
Again, the Bulls have had a ton of injuries tonight. Raphael Williams left with a mild concussion. Second down and 8. In the overtime, the Bulls have to score a touchdown. Blackwell, all kinds of time. Anderson at the 5, brought down there. A touchdown saving tackle by Eric Mitchell.
Yeah, that was a crucial play. Good throw by Blackwell. Here comes the tight end in the game, Guerrero. Let's take a look at it here. Just running a quick slant post over the middle. Good job avoiding the jam. Well, that's a tough, hard-nosed football player. Goes inside and catches that one.
First and goal from the 5.
Let's.
McMillan cuts back. And the Bulls answer.
Now
an interesting decision.
Very, very, very interesting decision on the extra point.
The question facing Jim Leavitt: do you go for 1 and the tie? Do you go for 2 and the win? They will go for 1.
Yeah, I think you have to, really. And Umholtz has been very good on extra points. He's 11 for 11. Obviously, the field goals have been the problem. A lot of pressure, though, on a guy who really is not a kicker, per se. I mean, he's a punter.
Usray on the hole.
Right down the middle.
On to round 2.
Yeah. You know what? These are really tough on the coaches and fans. When I was the head coach at Montana State, I was involved in a triple overtime game that we won, and it was a wild affair, boy. And this has all the makings of being just that. Yeah, this one is a good snap, good hold, right down the pipe. You got a new holder, of course. We got a new holder in Ussery, and now we're going to take a look at Mr. Grammatica.
Just the way I would have done it.
Yes.
Once again, the Bulls missed a field goal very late in the game, a 27-yarder. And they missed one earlier as well.
I really much prefer the college overtime rule as opposed to the pro football overtime rule. I mean, this is really exciting stuff. You know, the overtime in pro football can be a little bit boring at times. I mean, overtime is not boring. I mean, but, you know, when a team has to drive the length of the field, and you get, usually it's, it seems like it's a turnover that really decides pro overtimes.
Now they go back out to the middle of the field, flip the coin again.
Yep. Yep. So now South Florida is going to have the ball first, I think. Yep. Then they're going into the other end zone.
Now they're going into the band and all the.
Yep. All the hoopla and noise down there. Big decisions the head coach has to make in these situations. Oh, this is great. I love this.
You love it now because you're not coaching.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you don't need any of the Maylocks up here.
No. Maybe once.
Every now and then.
When Tim Henry comes in and does such a good job, you say, shoot, I'm
right.
Out of a job.
Did a good job, the young man.
He really did.
From Plant City.
He's really a neat young guy.
The junior voice of the Bulls. All right, from the 25-yard line. The second round in overtime. Both teams scored a touchdown in round one. The Bulls have the football first.
Quarterback draw.
Blackwell on his feet at the 20. Spins. 15. He's got a first down.
Boy, is he athletic or what? Yeah, he really does remind me, when he gets in this four wide receiver set, he really does remind me a little bit of the young guy that played for Florida State a few years ago, Charlie Ward.
And won a Heisman Trophy.
Yeah. Pretty good execution on the quarterback draw. What athleticism right there. Wow.
New Hampshire with another player hurt. Stephen Doherty. Makes you wonder if both teams will have 11 standing.
This has really been a tough night on the trainers and doctors for both these teams.
Jeez. Sean McDonald's team, very big, very physical. Even though it's a cool night, these biggins start getting a little tired.
Yeah. They really caught a huge break, though, on this cold front that came into the Tampa Bay area yesterday. I mean, they caught a huge break.
If it had been played even a week ago, would have been a lot more. It could have been suffocating down there with the humidity.
Yeah, and the IV bottles definitely would have been out. Woo, this overtime, I'll tell you what.
Well, the Bulls get a first down. They're at the 14-yard line in this round. Well, and you would think at the least they would be close to field goal range for either kicker.
Right.
Be it Umholtz or Grammatica.
Now, you be the coach. You have fourth and about two at midfield. Now, do you go for it or do you kick the field goal? Knowing that New Hampshire's going to follow you right out there.
Man.
Make the call.
I would think you've got to go with solid points. You got to score.
I agree.
And right now, they're right smack in the middle of the field. Both of the field goal misses for Umholtz, he's missed them to the left.
That's right. And they've been from the left half.
Jackson in motion. The handoff to Jackson with speed. Cuts back. Very little gain. And now the Bulls have another player hurt. Now it's Jimmy Fitz, the right guard.
Yeah, and he's had knee problems all year long. And he's also had some heat problems with cramps. So you wonder which is undoubtedly one of those two. Looking at his other leg, it looks like to me. Maybe ankle. How about that? 6'3", 318, sophomore. Played as a true freshman last year out of Bradenton. Boy, he is another man-child in that offensive line.
And with Fitz and Condra on that right side. Condren going 330, Fitz going 318. And it looks like it is the knee.
Wow. Other knee. You see the brace on his right knee. That's been the problem knee. Boy, oh boy, oh boy.
Join the South Florida Bulls as they host the Conference USA Volleyball Tournament November 18th through the 21st at the Sundome. Pick up an all-tournament pass for individual sessions. Call 813-974-3002 for ticket information. Great tournament. Conference USA. Second down and 8 in overtime. Round 2 from the 11-yard line. Draw. Smith at the 10, brought down. Mike Wells, a tackle for New Hampshire.
Stop at the 10-yard line.
Okay, third down.
Third down and 7 for the Bulls.
New Hampshire has the nickel defense in the game. Coach Hernandez is signaling in the play.
10 seconds on the play clock. The Bulls 3 of 15 on the ball game on third down. 1 second on the play clock. Blackwell under pressure. He's got McMillan. Touchdown, South Florida.
Well, that was a pressure throw. Boy, McMillan has been big tonight for the Bulls. Huge. Here comes another crucial extra point.
Well, McMillan hasn't had a big game, has he? 3 touchdowns. Umholtz. And the Bulls score 7 on that round. 42-35. The Bulls know what they have to do defensively. They have to hold New Hampshire out of the end zone.
Yeah, and New Hampshire now, you know, every play is in four down territory, obviously, for them. Now here's where the band comes into play a little bit for South Florida. Let's take a look at the replay. McMillan with what's called a hot release out into the flat. Terrific throw, long coverage. No question he's going to get in the end zone with his strength. Good protection. Excellent protection up front. Right on the money. Don't clip. Good.
4 touchdowns for Darryl McMillan. How about that formation? Washington. Good game. Looked like he had a diamond out there at the top of the screen.
Now that's a new one. You're going to get new stuff every week. You know, they have not seen any of the Emery and Henry, which is really, you think that's wild. Wait a minute. If you see that one, you'll recognize it right away. There's linemen and players spread out all across the field.
Second down and 2. Curry, we haven't seen him for a while. He gets knocked behind the line of scrimmage. Roy Mann. Huge play on second down.
Yeah, now, you know, it's third and about 4. Now, you know, obviously, they have 2 plays to make this 4 yards. Boy, Roy Manns has really played a heck of a game tonight. That's a big back he's taken on right there.
Third and 4. Play action, quick pass, the fullback. He has the first down, knocked out of bounds inside the 5.
Well, it was a blitz, and they blew the coverage on the back and the flat. That's exactly what happened.
He has run out of bounds at the 4-yard line.
first and goal from the four.
Now they've done some wild things down here with some different kinds of option plays and everything else. There's Coach Kravitz, boy. What a tough night.
42-35, the Bulls in the second round of overtime. Play action. Day complete. Washington touchdown.
Play pass is complete for the touchdown.
Okay. Now, again, got to make the extra point.
Washington had a 75-yard touchdown run early in the game. Has another one in overtime. And Carbonara in to tie the game and force yet another round of overtime.
Remain Washington on the sideline.
This has been a knockdown dragout. Here comes Shevitz. And the fake.
You got it?
Day looking for the quarterback.
Oh, that's it. That's the game. Wow.
Day was looking for the kicker, excuse me. And with the missed point after attempt, Jim Leavitt and company leave with a victory.
And on the front side of the play, they were wide, wide open. But he tried to throw it back, and they just didn't get it done. Unbelievable football game. Unbelievable. Two weeks in a row.
42-41.
Jim Leavitt, the Bulls.
Beat New Hampshire. They knew they were in for a wild one tonight. New Hampshire, one of the top offenses in Division I AA. So balanced, did so many different things offensively, and they lived up to the billing tonight. South Florida knew it was going to have to try to outscore this football team, and the Bulls did it.
Well, you know, the challenge now is to just get a healthy football team put together to get on the plane to go play James Madison next week.
So the Bulls go to 6-2 on the season, rated number 17 in the country. They will now hit the road to take on James Madison, a top 15 ball club. In fact, James Madison is the leader in the Atlantic 10 Conference.
Yeah, and beat this team. So in that, now you got to go on the road up there. So that's going to be a tough road trip as well. But the playoff hopes are still alive.
The South Florida Bulls at 6-2, very much in the playoff picture, having to take on a top 15 team next week at James Madison. Then they're home November 6th for a Division II team. And then it's Hofstra. Let's go down to Leah Secundo and the coach, Jim Leavitt.
Thanks very much, Al. Coach, heck of a game for these fans to watch.
Well, yeah, it's wearing me out this year. Our offense did a great job. Our offense pulled us out. Our defense is playing great all year, but we just didn't play real good tonight. And that happens sometimes, you know. And the offense did a great job and just pulled us out of it.
McMillan is really coming along, a career high night this evening. Talk a little about his play downstream.
Well, he's an awfully good football player, and you know, he obviously did a good job tonight, and we needed him. We needed everything. We needed wow, what a game, huh?
Awesome game. Thanks very much, Coach Al.
A very spent Jim Leavitt as he leaves the field. His team a victor in overtime, 42-41. When we come back, we'll have a ton of highlights to show you. And there were a ton of highlights as the Bulls go to 6-2. Say a prayer, saying thank you very much for the victory here at Raymond James.